Rams legend Rowan Williams will join us.
My man.
And then after practice today in the 12 p.m. hour, the great Puka Nacua.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. He was just standing right here in front of us a second ago, DeMarco. That is it the 17, or is it just that he reminds me that much of Robert Woods?
All of it. Look at him. Did you see him? I mean, it looked like his helmet's too small. You know, I mean, that's just a big receiver. So I was telling him, like, you know, he's the guy that's going to do everything on this football team. You're going to carry it. You're going to catch it. You're going to have to block. Hey, I need you to crack on Bosa. I need you to come in
Robert
motion,
Woods would do it.
Crack down on Bosa so we can get this ball outside. You know what he's going to say? Yes, coach. That's what I like. So
does a rookie have another option?
Do you
have a nod? I'd really rather not.
And you're going to have to go through it until you work your craft, and then you can be. If you're good enough, you'll become Cooper Kupp. You'll be too special for them to use you in that spot. But until then, guess what you're doing?
Meanwhile, you had something about the Swifties.
Oh, about Swifties. Yeah. Like what constitutes being a Swiftie?
So
I like the music.
Would you like me? Would you like me to answer this, Emily?
Oh. No. We want Emily.
No, Travis. I want to see your answer, and then I'll clean up what you have.
Okay,
to say.
I'll see if you leave anything out. You go ahead.
Okay.
I'll fill in the holes.
All right. So I think that it's Swiftie is just embracing like the lyrics of her music. I think the most important thing is like actually listening to the words she's saying and knowing a little bit about her backstory because it makes the music a little better. But I think you can be a Swiftie and enjoy her pop songs, her singles on the radio, and you can be a Swiftie that knows her entire catalog. So it just has to be embracing and not being a hater of her,
okay,
but being a hater of her enemies.
I got 80% of that. I could care less about her,
it's okay,
her life, but she writes great
songs.
You.
Yeah,
and I'm into I'm into the lyrics.
You're in the minefield now.
Do I have to go to the show?
I can explain to you some intricacies of her life off air if you're interested though.
No, it's cool. I get that. I mean, that's where great stories come from. What's his name? A Ring of Fire guy.
Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash.
Look, it's all his life. I love it. I mean, I love it poured out in music. But
there's
do
a lot
I have
of
to
that are about to happen that he just compared Johnny Cash.
I'm just saying, but
do I have to go to the show
is what I'm asking. Do I have to go to the concert?
You know, you don't have to
be a Swiftie.
You can enjoy. So it's going to be recorded. It already has been recorded. So it's going to come out on, I think, either a Netflix or a Disney Plus documentary. So if you have a chance, you can watch that. But, you know, Swiftie is whatever you want to make it.
I'm okay with
as long
not
as you're not a
Swiftie,
hater,
I'm just
which
asking.
Is everybody else who listens
and
to
And stop the trying to start fights.
She left out a lot of
my job here.
Yeah. You, let me introduce you to Chris Morales, DeMarco.
Oh, my God.
he's not new here. You should know these things. She left out a lot of very important details. Let me fill you in on some of these things.
Okay, go ahead.
You have to paint the number 13 on your hand.
Not happening.
When you go to the concert.
Yes.
Only
when you go to the concert. You also bring.
What's 13?
That's her lucky number. It's her magic number.
I thought 13 was the bad luck number.
Kurt Warner wore it all right. That worked out for him.
Okay.
You got a Super Bowl because of a number 13.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. You need to have multiple wristbands that you trade when you go to the concert.
Not these, but like these.
You make friendship
I'm looking
bracelets.
Right at you. See, you've got wristbands on.
But not like the name bracelet. Like there's friendship bracelets.
Yes.
It's her bit.
But there's still bracelets like you're wearing.
I wear a lot of bracelets, yeah.
Okay, so they're okay, go ahead.
When you go to concerts, that's what you do. You make some friendship bracelets.
You make friends.
And you share it with people, and you have a community.
Could Chris trade one of them? I did a quick count. I think there's like 10 on his wrist. Could he trade one of those for a Swiftie bracelet?
He could. I'll bring on. I keep forgetting to bring yours.
Tomorrow.
I made you one, so I'll bring you one tomorrow.
That's great marketing, right?
You also need to wear a costume when you go to the concert.
Yep.
You have to wear like a specific Taylor Swift
like cosplay?
Outfit.
Yes.
Yeah,
I see. I know some cool people that cosplay. Okay, so we're okay. We're okay so far. We're doing good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, we got I basically have educated you on everything.
That's a Swiftie?
Yeah, that's a Swiftie.
You know, I may qualify, Travis. I may qualify.
I think
I'm there.
If you're good, and again, we're running out of shows. What, tomorrow's the last one, Em?
Yeah.
Tomorrow's our show.
Tomorrow's the last show.
So I don't know if we're
going to
get in.
Something.
I didn't know I was a Swiftie until now.
Well, now maybe you and I, we go take in the show, and then we'll go eat some of that Korean.
I thought a deal breaker was I had to go to the show. Look
Absolutely.
At this guy. Come on in here.
Absolutely.
Look at you. Looking like Men in Black. My man.
All right. So our first guest of the day, Rams legend Rowan Williams, joining us right here. And Rowan, I've been hearing quite a few stories about you from your pal DeMarco Farr here.
I only told one, Trav. Come on. Only told one.
Good to see you. How you feeling?
Oh, man, it's great. It's just great to come be at training camp and to see the guys getting ready for another season. And they took us over to sign a little bit.
Yeah.
And DeMarco, there were so many old school legends that loved the greatest show on turf. It was great. It was great, man.
You mean legend players or legend,
legend
fans?
Legend players. Legend
that were over there?
Hold up. Legend fans that loved the legend players.
Oh, so yeah, yeah.
They appreciated antiques. I was like, hey, thanks for appreciating this old guy.
At one point, we were the only championship team.
Correct.
I mean, have you ever thought of that? There's been a lot of people that have put on that jersey, that helmet, but we were the only guys up until a couple of years ago that actually won the Lombardi. Doesn't that trip you out?
That is really trippy.
Yeah.
Making me feel really old.
I'm just saying. It blew my mind. Like, we were the guys at the top of the mountain, and when Matt Stafford and Cooper Kupp, Aaron Donald, and Sean McVay, when they finally achieved that, I said, welcome.
Welcome.
Yeah, it's been lonely.
It's nice to have company, right? I want to go a step further, DeMarco, because what you were saying, that for a period of time, you guys were the only champions in the organization. Obviously, they added a second one a couple of years ago. But you guys kind of had something that went to a whole nother level, because you have a team that has a name, right? There's the Steel Curtain. There's the Purple You guys were the greatest show on turf, right? There's a champion every year, but not every year has a team that you can say, you say the greatest show on turf, everybody knows exactly what you're talking about. So it's not only a Super Bowl championship, but it's that next level of identification of the entire group.
You're exactly right. I think one of the things, DeMarco, that I start thinking about more the older I get is that there would be no greatest show on turf without a darn good defense.
Uh-huh.
That could slow down offenses, could get turnovers, make plays.
We were in the same boat. See, the greatest show on turf, people think it's Marshall, Kurt, Isaac, and Torrey. It included tight ends and a defense at one point.
That was
a total team thing. But then, you know, it is what it is. But, yeah, I mean, it was more than just a name. It was us. It was our passion. Now, boil it down after 20-some-odd years, you may think it's just a name, but it was – I don't think we called ourselves that during that time.
No,
yeah,
no.
We were just us. Yeah, just us. Crazy. Yeah.
You just go out there and kicking everybody's ass every week. And then call it whatever you want, I guess, right?
You know, people don't put it into context. It's like we were the worst team in the league the year before.
Yeah.
We were the laughing stock of the league. We weren't the team coming
us
in
the Bengals.
That had all the respect of the world and everybody thought we were coming. They thought we were going to be horrible.
And remember when they used to, like, advertise, like, your NFL mug, get your favorite team's mug, get a Raider mug, get a 49er mug? They would do everybody but us. I'm dead serious.
It's
whatever
so
they were
true.
Selling, they would put it out there, everybody but us, and it would drive us nuts. So that's the thing. We were out there fighting for respect.
Yes.
See us. Yeah.
When did you guys know? I mean, I remember driving around in my car listening to the game that Trent Green got hurt and thinking, they said, well, they're going to play Kurt Warner quarterback. And I'm thinking, the running back from the Seahawks is there? Like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, wait, okay, there's a second Kurt Warner. I get it. And then thinking, he's in the XFL or the Arena League or whatever it was, and he's a guy that's working at a grocery store. Like, this is never going to work. And then it's pretty good. And then it's very good. And then it's, oh, my gosh, they're the best team in the league. When did you guys know?
I'll let you go first.
Who missed that block? That wasn't you, was it?
No, it was Marshall.
It was Marshall.
It was Marshall. Which ironically was very motivational for him.
Right.
He felt sort of responsible.
See, I never blame Marshall. I always blame Rodney for that. Rodney Harrison for being that crazy dude in preseason. Who does that in preseason?
Rodney Harrison is the answer to that question.
They took him out of that stadium with a police escort.
I'm sure they did.
I'm not kidding. They had to walk him out of the stadium. It was crazy. But when did we know? We always knew we were good. We just needed a few more pieces. So I knew it was going to be different once we got Marshall.
Yep.
When we put Marshall back there on offense, and we had Trent Green, who was lighting it up, we knew we were going to be different. But special? Special. Beating the 49ers for me. Finally getting over that hump. Yeah. Is that the same thing? That's the same thing. Okay.
Because coming in, it was only my second year in the league. And so all I was hearing about was the 49ers, their dominance against us.
These are the Steve Young, Jerry Rice.
Right.
They used to laugh at us.
Punching on the goalposts and all that kind of stuff. And hearing from DeMarco, hearing from Kevin, hearing from different guys talk about that legacy for us to go beat them. And Isaac Bruce, there's a moment where you see a picture of Isaac when he scored like his second touchdown. And you see his arms like outstretched. And he's like, It's emotional because you felt like that was the time where he was like, I finally got this redemption moment, and it's done. It's done.
Oh,
and I could just tell when I saw Isaac Bruce really happy and emotional and for the first time really leaning in, I said, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
We played them in 1995. We just moved to St. Louis. We're playing them in Busch Stadium, right? They set Jerry in motion, and nobody went. Jerry got to the center and went back and said, y'all suck, and took off and caught one for like 60. I'm like, oh. Not only are they killing us, they're embarrassing us and laughing at us. Oh, it was terrible. Yeah, just terrible. But getting over the hump there. But I do remember, we were in contention with Cincinnati for the worst team of the 90s. Yep. Remember that?
Yep.
And we went up there and played them, and we won, our eighth game. And Dick Vermeil called us in. This is just eighth. And he says, congratulations, you're no longer losers. Like, it was guaranteed you couldn't have a winning, a losing season. Yeah. It was like, wow, you're right. And then from then on, it was like, yeah, we're never letting go of this. Never, ever, ever, ever.
What was it like having Farr as a teammate?
It was great because DeMarco, people don't really – DeMarco, I feel like your career was probably the most underrated, underappreciated game that you brought to the game. When you talk about
– Think so.
Listen. His size as a defensive lineman, he was not the biggest or the tallest defensive lineman. There was an age of Big Daddy Wilkerson and all those big guys. And then you had DeMarco, who was like stealth and quick and doing it. And he was one of the first guys that started using his hands in a meaningful way. The work that he used to do on his handwork used to have us all thinking about how we're using our hands when we played. This permeated to
let him know. Please, I'm begging you. Don't let him know.
Stop talking about his technique with his hands. I need to hear the wardrobe story.
Listen, listen. But the technique work that he used to do used to feel like he was getting ready for like a some karate battle or some kind of royale.
Yeah.
I'm like, this. Where am I? The NFL.
Yeah.
Where you push yourself to get better incrementally, where you maximize your human potential and go out there and play. And DeMarco was the poster child for maximizing your human potential, for being a leader and a consistent person. And that's the culture of the Rams. That's who we were. So for us young players coming in, it's like, that's who we are. We're a scrappy bunch of hardworking dudes that put it down every single day, who are good human beings, who just love the Lord, love God, love life, love football, and that's it.
Hated losing.
And hated losing.
Hated losing.
That's near the top of
practice,
the list, isn't it?
Couldn't practice either.
Look, I have all respect for anybody out there right now, all these young guys. But I guarantee you, none of them could make it through what we went through.
No.
None of them. Not one.
You're talking about the amount of hitting, the length of the practices, all of the above?
2-3 hour practices a day.
In full pads
hitting? In full pass, full go, hot. We didn't have a bunch of water. They didn't care about us.
Right.
It was different. I'm serious. It was like true Junction Boy stuff. But
get you more ready, or is it just older?
No music. No music.
So Vermeil took over a squad, and it was okay. But he had to run some guys off. So he had to make it hard. I mean, he had to turn up the fire and see who he had. So
is that what it was?
Yeah. It was rough for a while, but once we got the team established and set, he backed off a little bit, and we went 13-3, won the whole thing.
Yeah. So tell me about his clothes. Let's get to the important part.
Go ahead, man. Go ahead.
Come on, Roland. Give it up.
Listen. So I know you, if you don't know.
I was 282 pounds.
Right. With thick thighs, bodacious, gluteus maximus.
13% and so, body fat.
Right. 13% body fat. Damn. Looking really, really attractive. Yeah. I mean, really attractive okay, anyway. All right. But, you know, they used to have these things called biker shorts back in the day. Okay. You remember biker shorts?
Of course.
Okay. We had like our version of biker shorts. They're like gray, like our cotton pants that you wear underneath your shorts or underneath your
they're
you know,
called
pants.
Grays. Yeah.
They call them grays. Yeah. Well, DeMarco just wore the grays. And that's it. And so he was the only guy on the team that wore just the grays. But I'm telling you, he's bodacious. Thin waist, big thick thigh, you know, big
I
want
to feel free, man.
And then so when you sweat, when the light gray grays, when you
they're
sweat.
They're not light gray for long.
They're not light gray. Okay. They're only in certain areas of pockets. So it's sort of nasty but good.
Up the backside.
But you see him working hard. You clearly know he's working. But you're like, man, here's nasty. But he's working.
How tall are you?
6'5".
Okay, so big butt. I'm 6'1". So we had to wear the same size shorts, but they're 3X. So when I put on the 3X, they're too long. It makes me look like I'm 5'8". So I'm not
you need to get with some vertical stripes.
I'm not gonna roll them up like the 80s. So I'm like, you know what? Forget it. I'll just go with the grays, man. I gotta feel free. It works.
Yeah, he was free. He was free in the grays. So he's free in the front, free in the back. Sweat showing in certain pockets, depending on his work ethic.
Dang right.
Gray shirt, sweating, big. ferocious, you know, wow.
If the grave were wet, it was that sort of day.
I'm going to have to go through some old images to see if I can find you in the
grave. That's DeMarco. You can see it across the field. DeMarco over there working. There's DeMarco. Okay.
What was it like? You know, I've heard DeMarco tell me some stories about Coach Vermeil and just how tough he was and how much he loved his players, but it's kind of this weird mix of just this incredible intensity and this compassion that he had for his guys.
Yeah, I think that's the big part. It's about the love, man. It's about the love. And I think that one of the things he did when I first got to the Rams, which I couldn't even comprehend, he brought us all to his house to, like, have a meal. I'm like, we're in the NFL.
And okay, this is probably stupid. That doesn't happen?
No, I've never heard, never happened in college.
Hammered with your head coach? No.
No, not in high school, college, or the pros. Yeah. I mean, this is crazy.
No one could outdrink him.
Right. I mean, he like brings you to enjoy like to time and break bread and pour into you as a human being.
Yeah.
So I just appreciate that. Me as an emotional, sappy kind of guy, having a coach that also had a heart where he talked about things that matter of the heart. You know, he sort of appealed to our emotions. And for me, it's a guy who, you know, who just loved the game and was a heartfelt guy. It was really motivational. And then to see how he loved on his players, the guys who have been there a long time and have sacrificed and committed over all the years, you could just tell the genuineness and the realness. And then the last part was, remember we went to Philly?
Yeah.
And all the guys came for like that used to play for him, brother teams.
He brought Smoke and Joe Frazier.
You know what I'm saying?
No kidding. It's
like, it was dope.
Yeah, right? It's like, so those kind of things of seeing like the love that
he brought back guys that he cut.
Right.
Guys that didn't make the team still came and talked to us about him.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, that's what he told the guy. This is a team meeting. And he said, look, we're getting ready to cut, and I may not be able to keep all of you, but I guarantee you I will call everybody in the league until I get you a job. That's how I feel about you. That's what he did. He really actually cared about every human being. But if you got on the opposite side of that.
Don't do that.
If you got on the opposite side, if you were a guy that just took that kindness and threw it back in his face, then, I mean, he would turn to stone
That's
on
it.
You. Yeah, I'm just like, you know, if you're not part of this group, if you're not what we're about, then you just, I can't put you on the team with the rest of the guys.
He tried,
yeah.
To his credit.
Oh, there's
some names of some guys that my rookie year.
We're not going to say.
Correct.
Yeah.
But there's some guys that he literally tried time and time and time again.
Literally walked the guy out of jail.
Yeah.
Literally walked him out of jail and tried his best. And he just, you know. Some guys just can't get right.
Roland Williams joining us here from Rams training camp, Super Bowl champion on that greatest show on turf team with DeMarco Farr. You've got four rings on your hand, my friend. What else we got going there?
Four rings. This is just an ode to the game. Went to Syracuse. It's the Big East Championship. Played with McNabb back in the day.
Okay.
This is, of course, our Rams Super Bowl championship that DeMarco has one of. I took a little side time, went and played for the Raiders, AFC Championship with Tim Brown and Jerry Rice. And then this one is high school, man. I coached
Oaks
high
Christian?
School. Oaks Christian. Okay. I went to CIF back with Zach Charbonnet and Kayvon Thibodeau.
Oh, yeah.
That was a year where I coached high school football. That was awfully tough to get those private school kids to – you know, play.
Be tough.
It's just less players. I mean, it's a lot. Yeah. It's a lot to it, right? And so it was a great experience. I loved every bit of it. And of course, celebrate winning the title, man.
You know, Kayvon Thibodeau, you mentioned obviously went to Oregon, with the New York Giants right now, and Charbonneau. These, can you tell when they're in high school? Like, that's a pro. Yeah. Is it just pop out of just for sure?
100%.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, Kayvon was 6'4", 235, 40 pounds, running, getting off the ball. There was a couple of times I actually had to, like, put a helmet on and actually play tackle in practice just to, like,
to challenge him. Yeah.
Yeah, to challenge him a little bit to get him to work. But his battery and his motor just, man, was just nonstop. And just such a hard worker, man. Just a great kid. And also, like, a 4.0 student.
Oh, man.
An AP class.
Yeah.
People didn't give Kayvon Thibodeau enough credit for his intellect.
Well, I remember when he was going through the draft process and they're like, well, he's interested in things that are in football. I'm like, and the problem is?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, for certain coaches,
that's
the problem.
What I mean. But that's more of a coach's issue to me than it is the player. I mean, I understand there's 24 hours in a day. You're going to put in the time to become a great football player. He obviously is.
Some coaches covet knuckleheads because the game is important to them.
Any good ones?
Some, but they covet knuckleheads because they know the game is important. That's the only thing that keeps them on the straight and narrow is this game. And that's a hell of a carrot to hold over a guy. But there are some coaches that really appreciate what goes on above the neck. I think McVay's like that.
Yes.
I think he really cares about what goes on from the neck up than the neck down. So I think that's what makes him such a successful coach. But some guys, they want those knuckleheads.
Yeah.
If you have I had a coach tell me in college, if you have a class that interferes with practice, you will miss that class.
Mm.
I mean, he was dead serious. I don't care if you're going to med school. if that class starts at 3:30, you're going to miss it. Football is most important. So you have to make a choice sometimes as a young athlete.
Roland, what are you doing now?
Wow, a lot. Well, first I got three sons. My oldest is a sophomore in college, getting into engineering, entrepreneurship. My middle son, he's actually one of the top high school football prospects in the country, Justice Williams, 6'5", 205 wide receiver.
Okay.
He has a senior year. He just committed to University of Washington, so he's going to be a Husky.
A Big Ten
Husky. DeMarco went a Big Ten Husky.
How about that?
So he's a guy that loves snowboarding. He loves guitar. You know, it's the perfect environment for him, and very happy for him and going out to hang out with Coach DeBoer. And I got a 12-year-old son, so being a dad, I'm also an entrepreneur, like in a host of things, in private equity, just trying to make a difference, building and finding companies to make them special.
It's got to be such a treat to get to watch your son play, because you know what it takes. You know what the sacrifices are. You know how difficult it is. You know how challenging it is. And to watch one of your own have success in that, just right? I mean, there's nothing. I have two boys myself. I have a daughter. And it's just, there's nothing like it when you see them succeeding in something.
It feels great. I think anytime our kids succeed at anything,
yes,
that's like all it's about. But if you want to choose what we did, that just makes it even better,
right?
It's like a little smidge better. Doubt. So helping him learn about the process and just giving him all the tips that I wish I knew when I was a freaking 7-year-old or whatever. All of his whole life, he listens.
What's the secret? How do you get him to listen? Because I'll say something, they'll look at me like I'm speaking a different language.
Because a wise man told me that we have to be a loving consultant.
No doubt.
You know, we have to communicate in a way that appeals to their intellect and their heart. These are, you know, suburban kids that are different than us, how we were raised. And so I just try to just present things to him. And he's like, Dad, I want to learn. I'm committed. And he does everything from the 5:30 a.m. wake up to the cold plunge to the jug machine to the lifting to the stretching to the roll, all the things. And he does all the things. And he listens to guys and hangs out around Cooper Cups of the world and learns and watches film. And he does it all. And so he deserves everything he's got.
That just means we can't headbutt him anymore, Travis. That's what it is. Can't take away the PlayStations anymore.
I'm not going to lie. I've enjoyed everything about this conversation, but the Grays are really going to stick with me.
Oh, come on, man. Can I ask one more question before we go?
They stuck with me, too.
I got Roland right here. I'm looking at Tyler Higbee, and that could be the greatest tight end in Rams history. I mean, you watch him closely?
Yes, I do, and have enjoyed watching him play. The great thing that he doesn't get credit for is that he is a two-sided tight end.
He can block.
At the point of attack, he's aggressive, he's relentless, and he's consistent, which is hard to do in the league, and these athletes are crazy. As a receiver, I just think that he doesn't get enough opportunities to get the ball, and you can't sort of...
That sounds familiar.
I'm like,
wait a minute. Okay.
That sounded like it came from a certain place.
A deep place. Listen, you have to get tight ends involved early in a football game. Because when you wait, we're blocking. Our physical hands are being used for violence. It's very difficult. It's a very unique position because we have to be so violent with our hands every play. And then you let us get stone-handed. Then late in the game, you try to – like, come on, man. You got to mix this thing up. You got to get tight ends going and make sure that we have both sides of our circuitry working.
So take me through it. You go back into the huddle, and there's Marshall Faulk, and there's Isaac Bruce, and there's Torrey Holt. And you're like, damn, where's mine?
No.
Like, how does that work?
No, I was different. No, here, I was different. See, I was like – I understand why I'm not getting the ball. Can't wait to go block. Okay, back to block Ryan. And then when one came my way, I'd be like, thank you, Lord. And that's why DeMarco know. I catch like a 6-yard pass. I'd be like, whoopee. I yell in the practice and take it like 80 yards.
Absolutely.
Every time. Like I catch a 12-yard catch, I'm taking it 75 yards. They're like, he's a nutbag. He's running 70 yards every time. And like, hey, thank you. I'd be like, Kirk, thank you.
Right, you got one.
Because I knew I wasn't. And that's why they used to be like, you better cover it up with two hands, because if you ever fumble and you'll never see another one again. So you watch the film, you watch like, why was Roland so conservative as a receiver? Because
I want another one.
That's it. There'll be no fanciness out of me.
Roland Williams is a Super Bowl champ. Of course, he is a Rams legend. Roland, enjoyed it very, very much. Thanks so much for stopping by.
That's great, man.
You got it. All right. More Travis and Slee. DeMarco's in for Slee on 710 ESPN. And let me tell you, if you get hurt in an accident,
Black and Gold dominated in their League's Cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Galaxy, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bouanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Forget about it!
Travis and Sliwa with the Rams Super Bowl champion DeMarco. We are live from Rams training camp. We're going to do Hey, Did You See?
Yes.
With producer Jorge in just a moment. But do you have a fantasy league that you want part of our ultimate fantasy football draft party? Friday, August 18th at the Hollywood Park Casino with the 710 crew. Register right now. We got about a week here at ESPNLA.com and be with us for a fantasy party, Hollywood Park Casino. Eat, drink, draft. Producer Jorge, are you ready, Carnal?
Yes, sir. Hey, fool, did you see?
Let's do it right now.
All right, fool. So did you see that Trace Thompson got traded to the Chicago White Sox? And he took his dad's number 43 jersey as, you know, as his number, 43, just like his dad, Michael Thompson, the Laker champion. So let me ask you, Travis, you played baseball. DeMarco, you played for the Rams. What made you pick 75? And Travis, what number did you wear when you played baseball?
So I was number 22 in high school and college, and it was very simple. And I think this is the way that you pick one of two things. You pick, like, Trace because it's a personal thing to you, or you pick a player that you admire. And when I was a sophomore at Arcadia High School, there was a senior on our team named Eric Grubin, who was an all-CIF player, was a Division I prospect, all these things. He wore number 22, and he was the best pitcher on the team. I'm like, I want to be like that dude. And I picked 22, and I was 22 from that point forward. And I wanted to be like Eric Grubin, and that's why I picked it.
No doubt. Yeah. Same thing. for me, it was Howie Long.
Howie choice.
Long, 75 with the Raiders. I mean, that number looked cool. I liked the way he played, and I stayed with it. Did I tell you the funny story? When I made the team, I was 94 as a rookie.
Okay.
Undrafted rookie free agent, so they gave me 94. That's not my number. I wore 75 my entire life. So I made the team, and I went to the equipment guy and said, I need number 75, not realizing what I just did. I just asked for Deacon Jones's number. He thought I was kidding. And, like, he's looking at me. I'm like, what did I do? He goes, and he points behind him, and there's a big picture Deacon. I'm like, oh, my God. So he made me walk outside, find Deacon, and ask him if I could wear it.
What did Deacon say?
Deacon said, look, are you any good? I said, I'm okay. He goes, okay, look, promise me one thing. When you get to the quarterback, you put him in the graveyard.
Sounds like Deacon.
I said, I'll do my best, sir. He goes, no, graveyard, or I'm taking it back. So went back, got it, wore 75.
He should have taught you the head slap. It was probably gone
by
the time you got there.
Yeah.
Deacon knows how to
crazy
those hands.
But that's why.
Allie, how about you? What number jersey did you wear?
So I wore 6 when I did high school sports and stuff, and when I played water polo, because 6 just seemed to happen a lot in my life. Just, like, numbers showed up. So, like, my address when I grew up had 2 6s in it. My phone number growing up had 3 6s in it. I was born on June 6, 1996. 6s were everywhere.
1996?
So, yes.
Oh,
wow.
Sorry, guys. Sorry.
You're June 6th? I'm June 9th.
Hey, Gemini.
Yeah, no wonder we get along.
Yeah. So I did 6 for everything.
Ninth, I'd already been in my profession.
Born after the OJ trial.
Yes.
Dang.
True.
When you put it like that.
There are landmarks in OJ 94, right? That's a whole other thing.
I was in kindergarten in 9/11, so we already brought it twice today.
You were born and I was already working.
You were a guy.
I was an adult with a job.
You had responsibilities.
I was dealing with stuff. What's next, Jorge?
That's why I call you old.
All right, so did you see that Serena Williams did her gender reveal party, and she used drones to reveal the gender of her baby? Emily, can you elaborate on this one?
Yeah, so essentially her and her husband, Alex, they had just drones go and, like, go in the sky, form the it's a girl, and just react to that. So it's just kind of like it's an elaborate way, let's just say, to do a
gender reveal parties.
Yes.
DeMarco?
How do we feel about them?
Yeah.
Or that one?
Yeah.
Both. That's the same as Mayweather burning money. You know what I'm saying? When he burned 100. Come on, man. Just
the
say
money
it.
Laundering.
Yeah. I mean, gender reveal parties. I'm kind of out on them, I guess. You know, no biggie. Just let me know what to buy. You know?
Right. Do you want pink or blue?
Thank you. Yeah.
And if you don't want to ask, just get yellow or green.
Thank you. Something neutral.
You're good to go either way. I don't mind. I mean, we didn't do any. It really wasn't a thing when my kids were born. They weren't doing gender reveals. We were going into the delivery room blind. We had no idea.
Yeah.
All 3 of ours didn't know, boy or girl. We didn't know what we were going to get. So very few genuine surprises in the world. So that's what we went with. As far as a drone show to do it, look, Serena Williams has earned every last cent she has, so if she wants to spend it on drones, go get it. That's up to her. She can do whatever she wants. I get it. You look and go, I could have done something with that dough, but it's her dough.
You spent $15K on something you could have did via text.
Girl.
Okay. Right.
Just baby emoji with a pinker.
That's it.
Pinker blue.
I also feel like this is something that people do a lot for, like, their first kid. Again, this is the first kid they have, and they're going to do all those steps, and then once that second or third or fourth kid comes along, then it kind of, like, gets less and less special.
You're right about that.
But,
I find it funny when these fools, like, want to bat a ball and they suck at baseball. Every time, or they have a balloon and balloon
or golf
away,
club, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
I love when the dad is too happy or sad. When it comes out blue, he goes berserk.
You've seen Gordon Hayward.
Yeah,
right?
I was going to say, Gordon Hayward's been with
the Gordon Hayward's my favorite one. I believe he had 3 daughters, and they were having a 4th child. And they did a gender reveal where he opens a box, and balloons are going to come out of the box. Pink or blue balloons. And he opens the box. The box opens up, and a handful of pink balloons go up in the sky. And he's like, bam! Okay. I'm sure he was thrilled, but you could just tell he really wanted those balloons to be blue.
For that, I wanted to keep going.
Yes, for sure.
DeMarco, are you going to come to my 40th birthday party? Because I'm going to do a reveal at that thing.
Party,
what are you revealing? What?
You'll have to come and see.
Only you. See? Yes.
Do you have a venue picked out yet?
We're working on it, and we need to move it all the way to the back of September, which is fine by me. I don't care. Because of Cappy.
You're not 40
yet? Are you
going
to share it again with Greg?
No, because this isn't September 1st. Mine is actually Tuesday, September 19th, which means you guys all will share in the festivities on a live.
It'll be a lit Tuesday.
Put it in your calendars already, guys.
We're going to do the party.
Why are we postponing? Because of Cappy.
it's hard for – I mean, the man drives me home at least once a week. He's got to be part of the festivities.
Oh, is he okay. – he's out?
Yeah, he's got something.
Okay.
I like it.
All right. All right. Cappy can be a part. One more, Jorge, or are we good?
It's up to you guys. You guys want to do one
more? Let's
do
one more. Yeah. Let's do one more.
All right. So the OC Fair is going on, and if you happen to be there last week, you might have ran into Bad Bunny. And if you took a picture, you're one of those fools that took a picture with Bad Bunny, let me tell you something. It was an imposter. It wasn't Bad Bunny. It was a guy dressed like Bad Bunny. He had security guards around him and the whole nine. So it was just a prank. It was no Bad Bunny. So if you got a picture, you know, too bad. So what is that one celebrity that you would want to have a picture of or with?
You know, there's
if you saw him in public, obviously.
I don't know if it's a celebrity. I think it would be an athlete for me. I think it would be Otani. I think that's the only person I would stop and say, hey, do you mind if we do one? Because I don't really do a whole bunch. I'm happy to do them.
Yeah.
And I've asked a handful of guys, Nolan Ryan, George Brett, one or two others that I've had, Cal Ripken, that I've asked to take some pictures with. But I think Otani's at the top of the list. If I saw him at the mall or something, do people still go
in
to
a
the
Dodger
mall?
Hat?
Yeah. I can put a Dodger hat on for
that?
Sure.
Yeah, something's happened there.
Yeah, Otani.
I did that, filled in, and they said you were going to cry if he didn't make it to the Dodgers or something.
I don't
got
know.
Got him going to the Dodgers?
Look, he's going to get there. He's just not going to get there on the schedule that I was hoping.
You really believe that? Okay.
I believe it in my bones.
Okay.
Travis did like 42 Otani shows in a row.
Is that what it was? Okay, that's what it was.
They did it exactly wrong. If they would have listened to me, maybe they wouldn't have lost seven in a row. Maybe they wouldn't go sinking to the bottom of the division the way they have.
No doubt. Is the question like whether I'd take a picture with a fake celeb?
No.
Is there anybody you want a picture with?
Oh, it's a real celebrity.
Yeah, anyone you want a picture with.
Oh, my God. You know, I do have a Bill Russell autograph.
No kidding. He doesn't do many of those.
And yeah. I got him to do it on a sports show. So I have one of those. So that was cool. I got a picture, too. It would be like an actor, maybe De Niro,
yeah.
Pacino. If I saw them, I would go gaga.
Yeah.
I went nuts after Michael Jackson, and I forgot as I'm running to him that he doesn't know me from Adam.
He just sees a big dude coming his way.
Right, yeah, he freaked out a little bit. Yeah,
sack him.
A little bit, and security stepped in. You know, I'm like, oh, he doesn't know me. I forgot. My bad. Michael, I love you. But it would be like, you know, Al Pacino, De Niro, Denzel. Yeah, one
Taylor Swift for you, right, Em?
Yeah, obviously. And then I think probably Greta Gerwig, who's the director of Barbie, or Margot Robbie.
Oh.
Either of them. Because I'm thinking in my mind
I'd
of
like
someone.
I'd like to change my answer to Margot Robbie as well.
Of someone who like wouldn't be mean to me, yeah. You know? Someone who actually might be nice. And I think both of those people might actually be nice. And so that's why.
Chris?
What was it?
If you've a celebrity that you want to take a picture with.
I think Jordan.
Michael
yeah,
Jordan.
That's a good one.
I think so.
I already
or
met Danny
George Serrano.
Yeah.
I got a few of those already.
You could make I feel like I could set that up
I
if you really want
yeah, to. I got a few of those.
Make that happen along the way. All right. DeMarco, is that Julio for you, Jorge?
Hell yeah.
Well, you better hurry up because he's leaving. Otani's coming and Julio's leaving. That's how that's going to go.
All right.
The Pac-12, gone.
Gone.
It's all but officially dead. We got one more season. You're a Pac-12 guy. What does it mean? And does it? It hurts me. I'm wondering what it feels like for somebody that went to one of these places. That's coming up next. It's Travis Slee. DeMarco's in for Slee on 710.
Okay, what's for dinner tonight? How about Waba Grill's new Boom Boom Tacos?
Yeah. Mancuerdan dos, lejos y amar a una mujer con la ilusión de
Yeah, that's one of those things. It's like the kid screaming in the grocery store, right? If you complain about it, he's going to keep screaming. You ignore
Sam
him,
Pines,
you
our owner, just walked in. I told him, I need some money to make Swift 710 t-shirts. We might get sued.
Did he give it to
not.
You?
No.
No, okay. Wait,
most
wait.
Likely, he just gives me this face.
Yeah.
Just a very,
that's
like,
a no. Chris,
walk away space.
Here's
no
the
face.
Vision, okay? So there's a design for the Eras Tour that it's like a square with a bunch of different eras of Taylor Swift and then herself in the middle. So
right.
Different pictures. So we could have all of our hosts / producers do the, like, model the same
really?
Pose and then have someone in the middle, you, in the middle, and it's like the ESPN LA Eras Tour.
Or you could be just holding me like a little baby.
I need to show you the picture because then I can describe it better, but I think that's a good idea for
what?
A t-shirt.
I'm holding you?
You're holding him like a child.
Like you're rescuing me.
I came in halfway through the combo.
What, that's okay.
I'm holding him.
Yes.
Where? Why am I doing this?
We could do Swift 710 t-shirts
that
mimic her Eras Tour logo. And you will be carrying Chris in this logo, what? I guess, is what we've decided on.
What do you think about that?
Depends on whose idea it is.
It was my idea.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We can roll with it.
I like it.
No, but we can definitely do it.
I'm looking at the pic. So this is kind of the thing we're looking at here. That's the t-shirt. So this would be you, DeMarco.
No, we're not.
Chris.
No. I just saw the t-shirt. Okay. The concept. Wait, hold on.
It could have been lovely.
No.
Yeah.
But it's Swift 710, the Eras Tour or something like
love
that,
it.
Too. Would be
something
funny.
Like that.
Yeah, but I think Slee was probably at that game yesterday for the Dodgers-Padres.
Did he go?
Nice.
I'm assuming. I think he has a somewhat season ticket.
He's like, got a partial package, yeah.
Yeah, partial package.
Oh,
so
does?
I'm assuming
he does. He does. He saw what's happened just about every time those two teams have played each other.
A huge meltdown, lots of runs.
Yeah, Padres jumped out big, and then Dodgers went right back out and took care of business the way that they have. They've beat them something. I want to say it's something like 39 of the last 49 times they've played in the regular season.
Wow.
The Dodgers have won.
Some
so
teams.
39 and 10.
But who won them when it mattered?
Okay, so I have a theory. It's a little bit of the reverse Rams-Niners thing. The Niners have beat the Rams over and over and over again during the regular season. But when it mattered the most, the Rams beat them in the NFC Championship game. The Dodgers and the Padres
keep
kind of had a similar
away,
dynamic.
Jorge.
Yeah, I'm pretending. See, just like we were talking about with the Swift, you got to pretend you don't hear it, Emily.
Oh, yeah.
And then he'll stop doing it. But with the Dodgers, they just beat the Padres like a drum. And then all of a sudden the Padres get them. What is that dynamic where it's just that when it matters, all of a sudden none of that track record, you're just smashing somebody matters.
So it's funny, like when the game goes on and each game has its own complexion and you know why they won and why you lost, right? But once you get beyond that and the media gets it, all they see is the streak. They beat you 17 times in a row. But the last 10 times, it came down to the last two plays.
Mm-hmm.
And you got better players than we do. We just couldn't make that play. So it's sometimes it seems one-sided, but in reality, it's not that one-sided. We just need one more guy.
Can
or
the
one
players
more player
compartmentalize it like that? Because, look, I agree. I'm a mental midget, and I think about everything that might happen and everything that has happened, and I'm not great at being in the moment at any given time. But if you and I were playing a game, if we're playing pickup basketball, and you beat me 20 times in a row, I'm not going into the next one thinking, oh, today's the day. I'm like, he's going to beat me 21 times.
If we're playing like we're playing to 11, and I beat you, what, 10 to 11, or you got to win by two, like 19 times in a row, you're going to want to play me again because it was close. It's right there. You were almost beating me twice or nine times in a row. So sometimes it's like that with football teams or baseball teams. It seems like it's one-sided, but it's really not. It's just you're beating us on one or two plays. There was a time when our special teams coach pulled up every reason why we lost to the Niners. This is when we're trying to get over the mental hump. And it was all stupid stuff. Like the ball would come out. We'd strip the ball out of Steve Young's hand, but the ball would bounce back to them. Like eight times in a row. It's like God hates us for some reason. Seriously. What he was trying to say is it's not you guys. It's not us. It's not what we're doing.
Yeah.
We're close. We could beat these guys. So, and he was right. We were right there. To break in that streak long before that game we were talking about with Roland.
Yeah, I'm going to add that to the list that's about 900 reasons long, DeMarco, why I was not a professional athlete. But I it would bother me. It would get in my head. It's one of those things. And maybe it's a little bit like when you play in your dad or your older brother, one of those things. Like when you finally get, it's like, oh, I can do this.
I got thrown out of an apartment building once because my best friend came to town. Remember that game, Fight Night? I'm sure Jorge knows. Fighting out on PlayStation, boxing game, and he kept beating me. And I'm like, we're not stopping until I win. And we went all night, from 6 to 6 in the morning, and I'm screaming when I finally beat him. I mean, I went nuts, and they were like, you guys have to leave.
I could have used you with my Factor Cap yesterday. So we did a Factor Cap based off of something that happened at Winning Time where they all play Monopoly and got upset with each other and whatever. So I was talking about how my family has certain games that we cannot play anymore because people get really upset about it. So one of them is Monopoly. We can't play Monopoly anymore because of my cousin. And then another one is like, have you ever played Spoons?
What spoons?
Do you know? So it's essentially a card game, but there's a bunch of spoons in the middle of the table, but there's one less spoon.
Think musical chairs.
Oh,
yeah,
definitely
musical chairs
not.
With
no.
spoons
yeah.
and cards. So you have to, like, once someone gets a certain suit, then you go. They grab a spoon. They can do it either slowly and out of sight or quickly. And then as soon as you see a spoon move, everyone can go get the spoons. And it has broken tables in the past, like where people are like
so if you're
lunging
left out,
to get
you're
a
out.
Spoon.
You're
yes,
out.
Exactly.
Oh, I gotcha.
So it's like
okay.
musical chairs, but slightly with card games. But yes, we have broken many tables doing that.
I could see that. Yeah, I could see that. But if you beat me, we're not done until I win. And that could go for years. But I'm never going to stop until I beat you. Never.
Well, the Padres are going to have to adopt a similar philosophy when it gets back to the postseason if they get in.
Are you scared of them at all if they get
yes,
in the postseason?
Yes.
No, you should be scared of Dave Roberts.
Yeah.
He's a gutless bum.
Stop. Stop.
He's
with
a
this.
Bum he's, in the postseason.
Stop.
You know that, Travis.
No, it's not true.
I can't wait for the show.
It's
when
not
we sit
true.
Around again, and I come in and burn his jersey and say he's gutless, and everybody gets mad. And you guys are like, it's not his decision, man.
It never is his decision. He is the, what's the phrase, Emily, soft skills.
Yeah, he's soft
skills. He's great
he's
soft skills.
He can't go out there and hit for them.
So.
He can't pitch for them.
Did you say soft skills?
Yeah.
Okay.
Interpersonal relationships, communication.
Right.
He's the brain.
He's the, hey, everything's going to be okay guy.
Yeah.
Whereas opposed to this pitcher in this inning, I think is more, if I'm being generous, collaborative.
Oh.
If I'm being less generous, it is, hey, this guy pitches to this guy,
I
and
gotcha.
That's how we're going to do it.
So that's a nice way of saying you hate how he handles the bullpen.
I don't think he's handling the bullpen.
Okay.
I don't think he has anything to do with it.
He doesn't handle the bullpen.
Yeah, what's that?
He doesn't handle the bullpen.
I think he has some discretion in how some of this goes, but at large,
hold on. What NL manager doesn't handle his bullpen?
Most of them now.
In this day and age.
Oh, really?
Most
this
of
is
them.
New. They don't handle their own bullpen.
They contribute to the decision making.
Who's
process.
Making the choice?
The math geeks.
Oh, so we've gone analytics.
Moneyball.
Yeah.
Oh my
the
god.
The eye in the sky.
The eye in the sky.
The eye in the sky.
Project one said.
The eye in the sky.
The only guy that doesn't get hit is making decisions.
Yeah.
Okay. That's smart.
Well, I mean that's the way.
Wow.
That's the way that it goes. All right. So I've teased this a couple of times. I want to get into it. The Pac-12 is dead, and I'm going to tell you how I feel about this because I have this from a different perspective than you do. Grew up on the West Coast, grew up in families that attended Pac-12 schools, USC, UCLA, Arizona, Oregon, like just right up and down. And the Pac-12 has been the league. Pac-10 for a long time was the league that you would root for when they would go play in bowl games, and you would be excited for a great Pac-12 matchup. And I don't know if it's just because I'm a West Coast guy and it's familiar to me. It's comforting to my family. I go to the Rose Bowl every, all of these things. Or whether this is not a big deal to think about. This is just the evolution of people going to bigger conferences for more money, and all of that nostalgia that I'm thinking about doesn't matter at all.
You're right. Yes, to all of the above. And the Pac-10, Pac-12, Pac-8, that was our conference.
Right.
It's the West Coast Conference, and it was us against them. Us against the Big Ten, play them in the Rose Bowl, that's one. Then it became us against the SEC. We play the best brand of football in college football. You get your quarterbacks from here. You get your left tackles from here. You get your best running backs from here. We got the fastest guys in the world outside of Florida. We fight with Texas over the same things.
Yep.
So the Pac-10, Pac-12, Pac-8, that was all us. So to see that go away, yeah, man, I'm a holdout. I am. I'm disappointed in the pack, in the suits and the execs. We should have fought back. You should have read the tea leaves a long time ago, and you should have become the super conference.
They
we
tried.
Don't leave.
Their leadership was so bad because you go back to, I believe
Hold on,
it was.
Trav, I apologize for breaking news in the middle of this Pac-12 conversation. We'll get back to it. But behind us here at Rams Training.
Oh, my God. I didn't even see this.
A bunch of shirtless gentlemen with paintings. I don't know what it says.
What does
I don't
it say?
Either.
What does it say?
I got an N-E-R-O-F.
I have a Nero, an E, a T in the back. What are we trying to spell,
fellas?
What
are you spelling, guys? What did he say?
That they're dyslexic and
it's
they can't
letters.
Spell. They just
oh,
put
just
letters together.
Oh, my God.
Well, I wish I would have known. I would have gone shirtless
it's
and posted
It's like a
letter.
Jumble. Shake them up and see what we spell.
We're going to have to take a picture with these gentlemen.
Oh, my God.
Is it like Nerf?
I yeah. have no idea what this is.
There had to be some.
Hurt, and someone has two letters?
Hurts of.
Heart of.
Heart. Heart of.
Heart of stone. Heart of stone.
No.
There we
heart
go.
Heart of stone?
They finally got in the right order.
This is like a.
Heart of stone. Okay.
It's
heart
like
of
Wheel
stone.
Of Fortune where you're trying yeah. to figure out what it is.
Heart of stone. Okay. Why are we heart of stone? Netflix movie. Oh, okay. We're advertising. I like this. Okay.
I love it. I love it.
They got more guts than me. I'm not taking off my shirt.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah. I'm not doing that.
Oh,
yeah.
No. That, I mean, look,
happen.
There's a reason to take it off. There's
he
a reason I don't even tuck it in.
The E over here couldn't wait to take a shirt
Trav
off.
And DeMarco, I'm going to read a live one, or why don't you go over there and take a picture with them? That way they don't have to stay in the sun.
He's
with
talking right. to you, Trav.
Yeah, no, it's both of us. I'm not taking my shirt
no,
off.
You don't have to take your shirt off.
No, we're going shirted.
Emily and I are over here. We got it covered. Oh, by the way, do you have a fantasy? Do you have a fantasy league that you want part of? For our ultimate fantasy football draft party Friday, August 18th at Hollywood Park Casino with the 710 crew. Be there with us. Register now at ESPNLA.com. You can click the Hollywood Park Casino logo right there, and then you could be with us for a fantasy party, oh party, Hollywood Park Casino. Eat, drink, and draft. I don't know if they knew, Em, that they didn't need to go make conversation over there. Just take a picture. But
yeah.
That's okay.
Yeah. We're
Jorge.
Trying to see if like how short Travis could get so that we can still see of, because they had to, he had, like, sorority squat a little bit over
yeah.
there to get underneath everything.
It is a very fraternal aspect of it.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah. I like the heart glasses. Those
yeah.
are definitely Taylor Swift glasses. People are wearing those a lot at the concert.
I like that there's a few gentlemen, Trav, that are taller
yeah.
than you.
There's a few. There's some big guys.
Yeah.
There are some big guys. Roland Williams made me feel like I was 6 years old again.
Finally, somebody makes you feel short.
That guy was a moose. That was a big
man.
Guy.
And yes. great on the radio.
Fantastic. The Grays. Like, tell me you're not, every time you see DeMarco, you're not going to be thinking
okay,
about the Grays.
Travis, I need you to watch the video that I sent you, which is
oh yeah,
which is DeMarco in a music video for Nelly.
Oh, my God.
Air Force One.
Stop
we talked
that
about
up.
It a lot.
Wait,
when
you were
on.
In the video? I never
yeah.
knew that.
Yes. Stop bring, you knew that already.
No.
Stop bringing
in
that up.
The video.
No,
no,
no.
In the video?
No. That version see. Of DeMarco does not exist anymore.
You have some breezies
no.
around you?
What oh, my God. That whole, look, never mind. Stop.
Was
they had me.
Was it
they
a
had
juicy
me at Gal Gadot. Huh?
Was it a juicy sweatsuit?
It wasn't juicy, though.
Hell
okay.
Yes.
I think
okay.
it was Pelly Pell.
Really?
Oh, my God. That thing. I must look like $2,500, $3,000 sweatsuit. That's how stupid I was back then. Yeah. Are
more
you kidding me?
How fashionable
me?
You were back then.
I was going to say, you were looking good, probably.
A sweatsuit I could have got for $19.95. And I pay $3,000
that,
for it.
That's the evolution of adulthood, right? There's this, hey, I really want that. That's going to
yeah.
make me feel good. It's expensive. You feel you look good. And then you're like, okay, I have it.
What am I doing?
What am I doing with
what
this?
What am I doing
and
here?
Like,
yeah.
You know who's got nice stuff? Target's got nice stuff.
Absolutely. So that video you saw me in, I'm sitting next to Ozzie Smith.
Oh,
he
the wizard.
Ripped me the entire video. Like, what are you wearing?
What was
How
he
much
in?
Did you spend on that? You dumb.
Ozzy was kind of square too,
big time.
Yeah.
And he's rich now.
Well, being in the Hall of Fame,
absolutely.
All those gold gloves along the way. Why not? All right, I want to. We'll go back to our Pac-12
okay.
conversation coming up here in just a little bit, because I, as someone who played in that league, DeMarco, as someone who, you know, you going through University of Washington, getting to the Rose Bowl was everything.
Yeah.
That was the goal of this. And
first
now,
word out of the coach's mouth. Yep.
Win the Rose Bowl?
Yeah, win the Pac-10 champion, get to the Rose Bowl and win it. Pete Carroll, when he was here at SC, when he was winning national championships, would start every meeting with the Rose Bowl. That was the Pac-10. That was the Pac-12. I'm so heartbroken that that's gone now.
So what happens next? That's coming up. DeMarco's in for Slee. It's Travis Slee, 710.
The Black and Gold dominated in their League's Cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Garnstein, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bouanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Forget about it!
Sliwa, the Super Bowl champion, DeMarco Farr, Rams Super Bowl champion, sitting in for Slee today, who's on vacation. We got producer Emily here, producer Jorge on the wheels of steel back, keeping us on the air. That was a little bumpy last time.
Yeah, a little bit.
It's okay, though. Okay, so when
it's going to happen. It's live radio.
When it's bumpy, it's more fun.
Yeah, it's live radio.
Right, DeMarco?
Yeah, absolutely. When it's bumpy, it's great.
It is.
What am I agreeing to?
Don't worry about it.
Hold on, see?
Don't worry about
That's
it.
That's how I get in trouble.
Last segment, Travis mentioned that Slee's got a partial package.
Yes.
At Padres, for the Padres. And of
partial
course
season package.
So here's the thing. We've been running. We talk about the fall, we like to redo the imaging lines for the shows, come up with new stuff. And we've been doing a lot of Travis and Sliwa now with producer Jorge. I think we say it Travis and partial package Slee.
Oh, my God.
He does have a partial package.
That's kind of working.
Partial season package to the Padres.
Right. That's just added. If you want to make it longer, Emily, you can. But partial package.
Host of the year and partial package.
Partial package.
I'm sure he's going to love that.
He doesn't have a full package. He has a piece of a package. Oh, it's a partial package.
By the way, after the Rams finish up their final practice today here in UC Irvine, Puka Nacua will join us. That's in the 12 o'clock hour, the Waba Grill lunch hour, coming up here on Travis and Sliwa.
Ooh, God.
I'm watching these guys work. And earlier today, DeMarco, you were talking about Coach Vermeil when you were playing with him, and he was kind of unique in that he would bring guys to his house and he'd feed you guys. You guys drink some wine together.
You cannot drink Trav. Wine, you're not going to come close.
Try with wine.
Yeah.
Well, wine is one of those deals where I really enjoy wine. When Susan and I go out to dinner, we'll get a bottle of wine. We'll share a bottle of wine. It's a nice way to kind of start your evening.
Yeah.
You have too much wine, there's nothing worse. Like, you have too much tequila, you can live with it. You drink too much beer, whatever, I can kind of do
just
it.
Just don't stop.
Too much wine
is the
only thing worse is champagne.
What? See,
I can't do too much tequila. That's too bad the next day.
Depends on what tequila.
Oh, my God.
That's true. I'm pretty cheap.
You do Donahue or you do our friends at Tequila Mandala?
Tequila Mandala?
Yeah.
You're going to be okay.
Yeah. See, tequila's good. I went to four of those Vermeil parties, and I used to wake up to the sound of corks popping, which means I passed out, and he's still going. Yeah, so that was his thing. So, I mean, that was great for us. Doesn't have to be for these young guys, but...
Well, speaking of young guys, Sean McVay is in his seventh season as the Rams head coach. He's still the youngest head coach in the NFL.
Look at him. Look at his energy, man.
I was just going to say, when they were running some goal line stuff down here earlier in the morning, he was covering Tyler Higbee.
Yeah.
Like, he had him, and he was picking him up in coverage. That can't be a normal thing that NFL coaches are doing.
And look, he Cooper Kupp reminds me of him.
Andy Reid's not doing that?
No, absolutely. Andy is pointing and yelling and give me the golf cart. But, Sean McVay, he's got so much energy. He's young. He can talk to these guys. He can talk to the vets. He can speak to the youngsters, the guys that are just coming in, musically, philosophically. He can teach you something. It's, you know, having a coach that young, I never thought would work. But here we are. With a guy like this.
Well, it's funny, and I'll give Coach McVay a huge compliment here with this. It has to be authentic. It has to be real. It can't be one of those things that, I'm going to be the high-energy guy. I'm going to be the guy that's in the mix. I'm going to be the guy that's doing all these things. And then when, you know, cameras aren't on or my true self comes out and you're not that guy, his is an authentic enthusiasm, an authentic energy, because and maybe it's just me, but there's nothing worse than the rah-rah guy who can tell is just playing a character.
It's a fraud. You know that. You can tell a fraud.
Yeah.
You know that. Players can smell a fraud, but obviously he's not that.
No.
And when he's out there working you, it's more or less, don't mess up my offense. That's why he's out there coaching it. I mean, he's very specific. He reminds me of a more energetic and athletic Mike Martz. Mike was the same way. Don't mess up my offense. Don't fool my quarterback. If I say 5 yards and turn left, I want 5, turn left. Don't go 6, don't go 7. You are messing up my concert. You are messing up my concerto. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I mean, be precise.
You're playing a different song.
Absolutely.
We're all playing this song. You're playing a different one. It doesn't work.
And he will absolutely explain why I need you to do X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
So it's not just you running routes, catching passes. You're learning more about football when you're out there with him.
All right, let's go back to your Huskies for a second. And this goes for SC and UCLA and all the Pac-12 schools. Is it just that we just got to get used to it that, okay, SC and Oregon and Washington and UCLA, they're all still going to play each other. Those will be familiar games. SC playing against Michigan, Ohio State, Penn State, Wisconsin, those are damn good games.
You got heat with them, yeah.
Those are really good games. So there's 8 teams that you're going to play, if not every year, a lot of years. I get it. There's going to be
– which makes you salivate some.
It does.
Yeah.
It's really good. There's going to be a Maryland and a Rutgers and an Illinois that aren't great.
Yeah.
You still had Arizona and Colorado in the Pac-12.
There's
still bad teams there. I get it that it's a more familiar bad team, but we're going to get used to it, right? I understand that emotionally
absolutely,
it sucks to see this thing happen, but if I get to see Michigan and UCLA and Wisconsin and Penn State play every year, I'm into that.
No doubt. Look, I am a USC disliker. I can't say hater. I'm a disliker because I'm standing in Los Angeles or close to it. But the Pac-10, Pac-12, Pac-8 was always better when SC was good.
Sure.
Because when they won national championships, the West Coast won national championships.
Yep.
So we kept the title here. So now it's a little bit different. You know, it's the Big Ten. If you win that, you're a part of that Midwestern feel to it, but you're bringing it back home here.
Damn, now it goes all the way. It goes literally all the way from Jersey to Washington.
It's weird. You're going to have to get used to it. But, I mean, like you said, some of those rivals are already built in. I can't stand Michigan.
Yeah.
I'm not in the Big Ten. Can't stand them. Played Iowa a few times. Can't stand them either. I don't want to lose to Ohio State. Can't stand them. Hate their fans. So that stuff makes sense. I get that. The problem I have is something I'm familiar with and love is breaking up. It's like a divorce. It's gone. Yeah. So, I mean, I wish that the suits and the execs would have got their act together and kept that group together and fought fire with fire and brought people to this side versus going the other way.
They tried. You go back to, what is it, 2010, I think it was, and the Pac-12 was the first one to move. They tried to get Texas and Oklahoma to leave the Big 12 to come to the – and they got to the one-yard line, and it broke down. And it didn't happen.
Over money, right?
Then Texas launched, and then it was basically Thunderdome after that. Yeah. Everybody started jumping all over the place, and the Pac-12 leadership was dreadful. Larry Scott was dreadful. George Kolaikoff, the new guy, hasn't really done a whole hell of a lot better. They couldn't get a TV deal together that made any sense. The deal that they pitched at the 11th hour to try to keep this thing together, the Apple TV deal, the Arizona athletic director compared it to Little League teams selling candy bars.
Wow.
It was like they were out there trying to go, hey, you need to sign up for Apple TV so they can get our chunk of the money that we're supposed to. It's like, dude, the Big 12's just and the Big 10 are just scratching $60 million checks. And you want me to go sell Apple TV subscriptions? Wow. It's a clown show.
But I did like what the PAC was about. The PAC was about the student athlete. They always were. I mean, that's the badge of honor. We are about graduating players. We care about you above the neck, below the neck, everything. But when you're competing against the South and those blue bloods of the – yeah, right. I mean, they've cashed in a long time ago.
Yeah.
You know what it's about. It's about winning and about money. So – if you wanted to stay together as a conference, you would have to change as a conference. And I think that's what they were resistant to.
And once SC left, that was it.
Yeah,
it was a wrap.
That was it.
Once SC decided to go, and you knew they weren't going to go without UCLA coming with them.
Yep.
And so you pull Los Angeles out of that whole mix, and then you don't have a league.
You have a league
of small towns.
Yeah, as soon as I heard that, when SC made the announcement and UCLA followed, I'm like, it's only a matter of time before Washington, Oregon will follow.
One of the things that will be – different, and maybe they'll still play it. And because SC and UCLA are both going, we won't miss it quite here in LA the way that they will in other places. But the Apple Cup, the Civil War in Oregon, Oregon State, Washington State, those regional games that were, maybe you can still schedule it, and maybe it still has the same impact. But if it's not a con, because I remember,
I was assured that the Apple Cup will continue.
Okay,
we will still play Washington State. They will not let that die. It just won't be at the end of the year anymore.
Yeah,
yeah. It'll be. It might lead off the season, which would be cool.
That's all right.
Yeah, derail like if Washington.
But is there anything better, DeMarco?
Yeah.
And again, you were at Washington. You guys were winning national championships, competing for national championships, going to Rose Bowl. But when one of those schools can get in the way of the other one, especially if it's a little brother getting in the way of big brother, like, hey, we just got to beat these guys, and you go into the Palouse, and it's snowing sideways, and it's like, oh, great. And you lose 10-7.
Let me appeal to M. See, when I was up there, 5 years at UW, we lost to Washington State once.
Mm-hmm.
And the other 4 years, we smashed them. I'm talking like 55-7.
Right.
The only game ESPN Classic plays is the one where they beat us. The only one.
Oh, no.
Right. They beat us in the snow, and they
was that like a Tim Rosenbaugh joint or a Mark Rippon or one of those things?
That was Bledsoe.
Oh, it was Bledsoe.
Bledsoe in the snow.
Okay.
Yeah. The only time they beat us. Yeah,
so
but they love it.
For UVA, when I was there, it was 25 years in a row Virginia Tech had beaten UVA.
In football?
And it's always in football. And it's always the last game of the year, and it's typically a pretty close game, maybe even overtime, but the – and then 1 year we beat them, and I will remember that forever. And Bryce Perkins, formerly Ram, was our quarterback of the team at the time, and I will always be indebted to him because of that.
Spoken from the other side.
I get it.
Right there.
I get it. I get it.
Right there.
I'm watching to our left here. They got a little 11-on-11 going right now, and you and I were talking this morning that you get your steps in every day. That you showed me you're up to 18,000 steps on
2,100.
21,000?
Yeah.
On average?
The last 2 days, yes.
That's incredibly
going
impressive.
Because
10,000 is hard to get to. That's kind of the goal. If you're doubling that, Sean McVay probably has 50,000 before lunch.
I'd love to. I'd love to test his blood pressure when he's coaching. I mean, that guy goes, doesn't he? He really goes, and he loves it. And he could do this all day.
Yeah.
All day and
love
it.
You get a sense that he's reinvigorated, re-energized, because he shows up. No one really knows what to expect. They're good right away.
Yeah.
Yeah, go to the Super Bowl, you just miss. You go back to the Super Bowl shortly thereafter, you punch your ticket. And last year was really the first year since he's been here where it's just a drag.
Yeah.
Right? 5-12, team wasn't very good, team wasn't in a lot of games. It just didn't work, which is life in the NFL. He was on the fence about whether he was going to come back or not. Made the decision pretty quickly, decided to come back. But it just seems that there's a little bit of lightness to him, having heard some interviews and things, that wasn't there at the end of last season.
From my perspective, I'll let him speak for himself, but I thought he was shot towards the end. Everybody was. It was tiring. Coming off a Super Bowl, I told Aaron, right, like within minutes of winning the championship, it's going to feel like you walked out of a victory parade right to training camp.
Yeah.
It's going to be short. It's going to be unbelievable. Defending a Super Bowl, in my opinion, is the hardest thing in the world to do, because you're still celebrating on the way into the next year. They got their rings within 3 weeks of training camp. So imagine that. You're celebrating the championship. 3 weeks later, you're getting to work on the next one. So, and then it all went south. So at the end of the year, God, he was tired. And there was all talk about he may retire. So, but what I said back then was, go take a vacation. Take 2 weeks and see if it's that. Just get away from ball for 2 weeks. Get some color back in your body and see if you still love this game. And sure enough, here he is. He's right back doing it again. So, but that going from Super Bowl to five wins, that'll take anything out of everybody.
Yeah, no doubt. And now it's a different challenge this year.
Yeah.
This is not a Super Bowl or bust team. This is a let's see if we can get in the playoffs and see what happens kind of team. A very different putt and maybe a more intriguing one from a coaching perspective. We'll talk about that coming up in just a little bit. But fact or cap with producer Emily. Coming up next, it's Travis Lee, 710 ESPN.
Black and gold dominated in their league's cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Gardner, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bawanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
vacation. We're going to do Factor Cap in just a moment. But first, the big important question. Do you have a fantasy league that you want part of our ultimate fantasy football draft party? Friday, August 18th at Hollywood Park Casino. You could be there with the 710 crew. Register now at ESPNLA.com and be with us for a fantasy party. Hollywood Park Casino. Eat, drink, or draft. We do it every day at this time around 11:30. Time for Factor Cap, Jack. Take it away, producer Emily.
Thanks. Also, Jorge, I thought I banned that song from coming in. I do not like that Taylor Swift song, Jorge.
Why don't you like that? Why?
Why?
That's
my it's her
one.
Worst Taylor Swift song.
It was used in like that commercial for 2 years.
Why is it so bad?
Play it back again.
It's the worst. It has such bad lyrics. It's so cheesy. I know that's what people say about Taylor Swift all the time, but of Taylor Swift fans, we all hate me. So that's the name of the song.
Well, now I kind of have a new favorite, Emily. Now that I know that one gets under your skin, I kind of might have to change my pick.
Sure, yes. And Chris, now that I've said it, it'll be in every open for all of eternity.
I'm just saying, you don't like to give me that kind of fodder.
Right.
Exactly. Fodder?
Right.
All right, so Orioles announcer Kevin Brown has been indefinitely suspended for these comments on Baltimore's recent record against the Rays. So, Jorge, can you play the sound, please?
For the Orioles, Brandon Hyde has felt like this has been maybe the toughest ballpark to play in, but the Orioles have a chance to do something special today. They've already clinched at least a split in the series, winning two of the first three, and they could pick up a series win behind Tyler Wells today. It's been a minute. The Orioles split a two-gamer with the Rays in June. They had lost their last 15 series here at Tropicana Field. You have to go back to when our now colleague Brad Brock picked up the win in the series finale June 25th, 2017, the last time the Orioles won a series here at St. Pete. Already got 3-2 at the Trop this year after winning 3 of 18 the previous 3 years combined. It is a stark difference, Ben, and it is not a bad Rays team. It's not like all of a sudden the Rays became slouches in the American League East. They've led this division every day, but now two, and the Orioles once again are back alone.
All right, so Kevin Brown will return to the Orioles broadcast on August 11th, according to multiple reports. He's been off air since late July after noting the Orioles' recent history against the Rays. So, again, he has just said facts there. He did not say anything that was untrue, and he was suspended for it. So this was an incredibly dumb move from the Orioles. Travis, Factor Cap.
Fact. I mean, it's so incredibly stupid and petty, and it's reflective of an organization that has not known how to be a good team in the better part of 20 years. This is so dumb. He didn't say anything other than this is how many games they've won over the last few years. That's
it. The record.
There was no editorializing. There was no piling on. There was nothing other than they've only won 3 games here in the last 18. That's it. That's not a commentary. That's a fact. Almost every single major league broadcast over the last day or two went out of their way to call it out for what it was, which was a bunch of crap. It's a terrible look from an organization that already has a bad reputation, and it got worse.
The guys on SNY last night were amazing. Keith Hernandez.
Yeah.
They were great. Michael Kay was
great. They went
great.
Off on it. Yeah. Look.
I didn't realize the Orioles had John Miller.
Yes.
I didn't know that until the SNY guys.
Yes.
I never knew that part of the story.
Yes.
I just always thought growing up he was with the Giants.
The Giants.
Sunday Night Baseball.
No, he was there. And look, even the Angels guys last night, that Wayne Randazzo and Gooby went in on it. It was baloney.
Kevin Brown, the pitcher?
Different Kevin Brown.
Yeah. Okay, so I got to go Cap. Because
okay.
Ben here, especially with this team when they weren't so good, we weren't told what to say, but you kind of knew what to stay away from. And when the record got bad, it's like, do you really need to keep saying how bad we are over and over and over again? Like, all we're doing is chronicling failure at this point. You know what I'm saying? So if he was told not to or asked not to and he did it anyway, then...
But aren't you just treating your audience and your listeners and your fans with an incredible amount of contempt if you can't trust them to hear the truth?
Yes. So he did what he was supposed to do, but if he was asked or kind of hinted not to do it.
If he would have said something like, look, the Orioles were a terrible team for 20 years and they couldn't do anything right and it was an embarrassment and I can't believe that they lasted that long. He said they've lost 5 of their last 25 games.
100.
It's crazy. It's crazy to me.
Jorge?
I don't want to get canceled tomorrow, so let's go to the next question.
All right, so Steph Curry was brought out on stage to sing a song with Paramore. Paramore is a punk rock group, and they have this song called Misery Business. And every stop on the tour, if there's someone that wants to come out, they'll come out and bring them on stage, and then they'll sing this one part of the song with them and then get going. So Steph Curry goes, sings this part of the song, and he actually kind of kills it. You know, he was on a rap song last week. He was in this song with Paramore just now. So, but put yourself in the shoes. You go to a concert. There is a song that you would love to be brought on stage for to sing with an artist. DeMarco?
Oh, that's a fact. There's a bunch of them. I'm trying to think of the Paramore
Air Force
song.
Ones?
Stop. I would go nuts for that, though.
I need to purr.
You got to say purr. It's purr.
But Misery Business is like, I watched his wildest dreams come true, not one of them involving you.
That song? I know the group, but yeah, absolute fact. There's a bunch of them, and the guy's dead. Prince. Mm. If I was at a Prince concert.
You get high like Prince? Hit those high notes?
Oh, I thought you said what I did.
I clarified. I clarified.
You would like to be get on stage and sing it.
I clarified.
We're on the radio.
I quickly realized what I said. Double back. Can you hit the high notes?
I
like
can.
Prince?
But if he brought me up for Let's Go Crazy, I would do it. Absolutely. Yeah, fact. No doubt.
Trav?
You know, my great fear, right, is singing in public. I can't sing a lick. I can't carry a tune. I can't do it at all. I wish I could. Can't do it. But if there were an opportunity, and they still do it, but go to a Cubs game and do Take Me Out to the Ball Game with Harry Carey and hang out of the booth and do all that,
nice.
I would be all over that.
Who got thrown out? McMichael. Yeah.
Vin Scully did it one year when the Dodgers were playing in Chicago. And Vin Scully, you know, Harry Carey's like, one, two. He's just, you know. And,
pretty good.
And Scully goes out there and could sing beautifully.
It was just
It was just this beautiful rendition of them like, this son of a gun. There's nothing he can't
nothing
do at all. He just goes out there and knocks it out of the park.
Wow. Wow.
Jorge?
Oh, my God. You couldn't wait.
I'm sorry.
These guys were at Coachella 2 years ago. So
that awesome.
I wouldn't mind going on stage with these guys.
That'd be awesome. Chris, do you have one?
No.
Eric Church?
I do love Eric. So Eric Church, Springsteen.
Yes.
Or Jack Daniels. That's like I told you, I was staring at a Jack Daniels bottle the other night. I've avoided this being a Jack Daniels summer. It's been a tequila summer.
Well, you and I have not spent a lot of time together. When you and I get together, the Jack Daniels happens.
Yeah. So maybe when we're together, if we're not together before.
Yeah, we will. I got a new grill, Chris.
Classic. Yeah, I got
a new grill. It's very exciting.
Jorge and I'll come see it. Yeah. You know, we've got a house.
DeMarco, would you like to come see the new grill?
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'll put some veggies on there for
you. What are we pouring?
Whatever.
Well, Jack Daniels.
There we go. Okay, absolutely.
By the way, tomorrow we'll do a little live imaging all day, and mainly because we're going to announce tickets, or not sales, but group sales for the ESPN LA Golf Classic.
Excellent.
Because we're getting a lot of those questions. Friday, September 8th at Black Gold Golf Club. Be listening tomorrow.
Exciting.
I want to play. I do. I want to play golf now.
Do you want to play?
I want to play.
Okay.
But not with Travis. He's too good.
Yeah. I guarantee you'll have a good time if you play with me.
Yeah. Okay, I want to play with Travis.
Some more of these flashes.
He's always got he's always got a bottle in his back.
I want to play with Travis.
I come prepared, shall we say.
All right, so today is National Whataburger Day, and I, too, lived in Texas for a period of time. And I have only been to Texas once, and I went to Whataburger once, was underwhelmed, and I felt like it's pretty overrated.
Good job, Em.
So
you
there
are a proud
is
American for saying that.
An overrated L.A. area restaurant.
Oh.
Jorge, Patrick Kapp.
What was the restaurant?
There is an overrated area restaurant, like a regional one that people are like, oh, I have to try X, you know.
Oh, people are going to kill me for this, but the hat, it just, the hat is not, it just doesn't do it for me. I don't know what it is, but it's just, the hat doesn't do it for me.
Okay.
DeMarco? It used to be amazing. It's gone down. Jorge's right.
DeMarco?
I mean, look, it's a cheeseburger, but I mean, I will fight tooth and nail for an In-N-Out burger, but it's still just a cheeseburger. I get it. I'm not going to fight over it. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to argue about it. But
that's what a hamburger is all about.
Okay. You and I have had a nice relationship for the last 7 or 8 years, and now I feel like we're drifting apart.
No. You need to come up. I got some good burger joints. But okay, I get it. You know, I'm not going to be mad at you if you don't like it. So, yeah, I'll go there. Sorry, my bad.
All right, Trav.
The L.A. stuff, not so much, but I couldn't be happier that you said we said about – first of all, everybody's incredibly territorial about their regional fast foods.
Yes. Right?
My thing is – my thing's better than your thing. That's what everybody – is. Whataburger sucks. There's just no two ways about it. It's not – good. It's never hot.
It's
never
just big.
It's just a lot of it, yeah. Which is fine. But I remember when I moved to Texas briefly, and everybody was like, "Oh, you're gonna love it." I go, like, "This is what you're all crazy about."
Yeah, honey butter chicken biscuits.
Nothing.
You know what
about
does live up to the hype though? Bucky's.
Bucky's is great.
Does live up to the hype.
Bucky's is great.
It's huge. It's awesome.
It's a truck stop.
Exactly. But you can get anything you want there.
Aisles of beef jerky.
Yeah, exactly.
Can't beat that.
That is true.
All right. So I got one last one for you guys. So I went up to Disney on Friday. I got stuck on a ride. I got stuck on a ride, Web Slingers.
Oh.
So it wasn't like a roller coaster, which is good. But you know, we had actually already finished the ride, and we were about to dock, and then it all shut down. So getting stuck on a ride is always jarring. Travis, Fred, or Cap?
Cap. I oddly don't mind it, because you can kind of see some of the details and all this stuff, because what Disneyland particularly does incredibly well, there's just so many little things that you don't notice when you go through at regular speed. But when you get to sit there for 5 or 10 minutes, you get to see all the things. And I always like the kind of the backstage stuff.
Yeah.
So what's really – this happened to me when I was Disneyland 2 or 3 trips ago. One of those new Star Wars rides, Rise of the Resistance, which is really, really cool. But – it broke while we were on it. They had to turn on all the lights inside, so you get to see kind of behind the curtain. It was kind of neat. It's not quite the same thing as just going through it, and I don't want to spend an hour in there.
Yeah.
But they literally turned on all the lights, came by, opened up the carts, and walked everybody out.
I feel like if it was It's a Small World or Pirates of the Caribbean, it'd be a little creepy, though, because those things have been on – music and those things have been there forever, and so they're probably, like, a little creepy looking.
A little haunted. Yeah, it's weird. Yeah,
Mark, what about you?
I got to go fact, man. It's kind of creepy. It depends on where you get stuck. Like, you get stuck at the top of a – what do you call those wheels?
The loops?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the Ferris wheel?
That's freaky, man. I mean, your life is in somebody else's hands. We did, and this is the most embarrassing thing, we got kicked off of Space Mountain because we didn't fit. We couldn't close the thing in time.
Oh, come on.
We couldn't lock.
Come on, man.
The guy I was with was 6'6". His knees were too long, so we couldn't lock the security thing. They unhooked us and just shoved us off to the side.
Oh, my God.
Just shoved us right off. It was the most embarrassing thing ever. Yeah.
I could just see the turn around. Yeah, we're good. We're fine. Don't worry about us. We don't fit into the rocket in Space Mountain.
We got two thumbs up and one thumbs down. Unhook. Get out of here.
Jorge, what do you think?
No, same ride as the Marco. Space Mountain is one of those. They turn the lights on, and you see all those rails and how close you're actually to those. Oh, that thing freaks me out.
Oh, yeah.
That is crazy. Heart of Stone guys just took a seat over there.
Are they in order? Or are they still playing jumble?
Who knows? Yeah, again, they're a little dyslexic. They're figuring out how to order it all together. But, yeah, that's all I have for you guys.
Brian, is Brian there with them?
Wow.
Yeah, Brian, oh, man. Catching strays, Brian.
Brian struggled with our little impromptu spelling bee that day. Okay, Brian's a good guy. You don't want him on your spelling team.
If you're
putting one together, don't pick Brian.
Okay, just haven't found the right
Brian
space
Cohen,
for him.
Of course.
Yes. Yes.
Part of the Mason and Ireland program.
Now that Jorge is here.
It's still something that's a little tender.
Not for
me. Not for the. You know.
Not for me. It's not. Welcome, Jorge. It's nice. It's a pleasure to have you here. Welcome back. All right. Go back to Coach McVay here in a second. Talk about what this year is different than every other year he's had coming into the season. That's coming up next. It's DeMarco in for Slee. Travis Slee, 710 ESPN.
That's Taco 48. Valid in-store or online only at Waba Grill. I'm going to be using that code because I want more Boom Boom Tacos. They're delicious.
They're pretty good.
And I had never been to a Waba Grill before we started doing this promotion and campaign with our friends at Waba Grill. They're good.
There's one right around the corner from my house. It's a regular spot.
The steak ones especially.
Steak's my number two. Chicken number one for
me. Chicken is number one for you.
Yep. Yep. Oh. All good, though. All good. If you wanted to give me the steak ones, I'm not going to look at you, honey. I'm going to eat them. Got to get a veggie option for DeMarco.
Of course.
Yeah. Plant-based.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
It's showing, too.
See, I think I hit my allotment on meat, so I'm not missing anything.
Like for your life?
Whatever allotment you had.
I could always take more meat, DeMarco. I could always take
whatever
more meat.
Lifetime allotment you have for cheeseburgers, I hit that.
But
I'm
no
good.
More K-barbecue? You can't
steak,
do that.
I overdid it for years, so I'm good. I can come back the other way for a while.
You really don't miss it?
Not at all. I have no cravings. It's crazy. I never thought I'd be able to say that.
Did you just cut out beef, or did you do chicken and fish and every just meat all together?
Meat, completely, yeah. I didn't set out to be whatever. Like,
what about
everybody
vegan?
Wants to
you,
see.
Yeah.
I don't want to put a label on. I just don't eat meat, and I stay away from dairy.
Okay.
Whatever that makes me. But
are you very strict about it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've gone to two different barbecues, like solid barbecues, where they had a lot of good meat, and I stayed away from it. And I had no cravings.
What did you eat? Did you have like coleslaw?
I brought the Beyond Meat, the Impossible Stuff. Throw that on the grill for me. Yeah.
So how did that go over?
It was good. It was cool. I mean,
that's
look,
not bad.
No. I'm more asking of like people being like, oh, they're making all the rest of the food. Like, hey, here I brought my Beyond Meat. Can you put it on
but,
the grill?
But
for
if
me?
The biggest dude in the room both times.
Yeah. 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 That makes it a little easier.
Yeah.
That makes it a little easier. But that's one of the. It'd be one thing if they're doing like burgers, right?
Yeah.
And you come in and say, now here I want you to cook these burgers. But if it's a different thing because you're trying to maintain the diet. I think everybody can get with
that. Yeah,
and the Beyond
on.
Meat ones, they're...
And yeah,
I've heard
that.
Of people. Like, I had them cook them all up. I said, try this. Yeah. I guarantee you'll like it. And they did. They're like, oh, this is good. Yeah. I'm
did
like,
you get,
it.
Like, Beyond Cheese or anything, too?
I do. I get the vegan cheese. Nice. Yeah. Every now and then.
What's wrong with you?
Can't do that one.
Dude.
The vegan cheese is not happening.
Trying vegan to be healthy. Butter Marco. Isn't bad.
Trying to be healthy. Yeah, come on.
I wanted you to carry me in that picture. Now I don't know. I need a man.
I can hold you up. Yeah, come on.
I need a man that takes the meat.
The vegan cheese is a non-starter. Like, just, I'll go, I can eat the burger. Like the meatless burger, but the vegan cheese is... I'm
can we put that to the test? I'll bring you a meal, and I'll have you pick between...
No, Keyshawn did this with us.
Have you guys...
I guarantee you won't be able to tell.
Do you remember when Key brought in the pulled pork made out of carrots?
Okay, really?
So it's shredded carrots, right? And he cooked it in the slow cooker and the sauces, and he gave it to me, told me it was pulled pork, and I ate it, and I would have never known it wasn't until afterwards.
Okay, there you go. See?
Yeah.
Have you guys ever, either of you, watched Parks and Recreation?
Yes.
The sitcom? Okay, so there's a scene in which they have a cook-off between Chris Traeger, who is a vegan, and he makes his veggie burger or a vegan burger, and then there's Ron Swanson, who makes just a plain cheeseburger, and everyone's like, yeah, plain cheeseburger is still better.
Wow.
Like,
Cal
still gonna go
turkey every time.
Yes. it's just, you know, it is what it is.
All right, DeMarco, so they're doing some more goal line stuff right here. Not the number one's not in at the moment. But is there something for Sean McVay, who has had really nothing but, hey, let's go win playoff games, let's go to the Super Bowl, and let's see what happens as his goal? And I'm not saying that still isn't the goal. Obviously, that's the ultimate goal. But this is a team that is not as talented, or at least as top-line talented as some of the others. You still got Stafford, you still got Kupp, you still got Donald, you still got Havenstein, you got Higby. You got some guys that we know. But a lot of new faces. Is there something energizing as a coach, as a coaching staff, to have a new group of guys and just see exactly what it is you have when you start playing games?
Oh, absolutely, man. I mean, 2018, I was geeked for that team, but it was different because it was loaded.
Yeah.
You know, a couple of years ago, same thing. I mean, I was geeked for that team, but it was loaded, so there was an expectation to win. This is different, man. You're starting from ground zero, and he's talked about this. Sean McVay has. Leading the team from scratch, starting over. There's something buying, you know, a pancake mix from the store and making a great pancake that way versus taking all the eggs and the flour and putting it all together in one bowl, mixing it up, and then cooking it just right to make it so good. So that should, you know, interest you as a coach, especially a young one. So you've got young guys. And look, he's in that rarefied air. He's a championship-winning coach. He's been to 2-1-1. So he's a made man in this league. Now, if you want to go to a whole new level, really, and level up, take this team to the playoffs.
Yeah.
Take a team full of young guys, make them better, make them into winners. You'll be certified forever in this league.
That's what's so crazy about it. Look, this is his seventh year as head coach in the league. He's still the youngest coach in the league,
mm-hmm.
the youngest head coach. He's already won a Super Bowl and been to another, like you mentioned. There's really only one thing left for him to do as far as, like, checking the resume of being on the list of those guys that are special, different, that he's been to multiple, he's won one. It's do it with a different group of guys.
Yeah.
That's it, right, Lori?
Yeah.
When you look at Bill Walsh or you look at Bill Belichick, you look at these guys, Andy Reid, guys that have gone through and been there a bunch of with different – you go with Donovan McNabb, you go with Patrick Mahomes, you go with just different guys and different – Belichick had Brady the whole time, but everything else changed across the entire thing. Do it with a new group of guys, and you are in the thinnest slice of coaches in this league.
You are in the elite group. They start making video games with your name on it. So, I mean, that could be where he's headed. That whole thing, you saw that quarterback show that Peyton Manning produced.
Yeah, yeah.
The thing that scared me the most was Mahomes is 27. He's not going anywhere. He's going to be doing this forever. Same with McVay. He's young. He could be doing this for a while. So whatever record that you think you have, he's the guy that can actually track you down. And there is one more thing that he can accomplish. So this would be one thing. Let's say you get the 2023 Rams into the playoffs and you make a run. You go to a Super Bowl. That would be amazing, right? Sean McVay would go to a whole new level.
Yep.
The next step would be do it with a rookie quarterback. Seriously, draft your own guy, not trade for Matthew Stafford. Matthew Stafford is great. And I had this debate with JB. Stafford is so good, he's starting his Hall of Fame run, so to speak. He's got the ring, he's got the numbers. So the next time they have a touchdown pass, is it going to be a great throw or a great call? That's where you're at. So the next step would be start with a young guy, a young quarterback, and raise that guy into a champion.
Did he not do that with Jared Goff? You know, put a pin in this. Yeah. I want to come back and I want to talk about this because he did. Like, they didn't punch the ticket, but they got damn close with a guy who a lot of people thought couldn't play dead.
Right.
Right. And he turned him into a Super Bowl quarterback. Plus, you mentioned Mahomes. We all just going to kind of sit here and say, there he is again. And there he is again. And there he is again. It's all coming up. It's Travis Slee. DeMarco's in for Slee on 710 ESPN.
Black and gold dominated in their league's cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Galestina, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bouanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Tuesday on Mason in Ireland.
Soon
Come
enough.
On,
close.
Chris.
Hour and 12 minutes
Hold
away,
on.
Chris.
Hold on for a second.
Chris.
Hold on for a
hour
second.
Hour and 12 minutes.
First of all, Mason will pay me for that. Second of all, I was just listening to a highlight from yesterday's show where John Ireland, of all people, is in on the bit and was reciting the lyrics to this song. So that's why that was in my head. It is Travis and Sliwa.
Thank you.
The Waba Grill Lunch Hour begins, home of the Boom Boom Tacos. And also, we are the home of the Rams Super Bowl champion, DeMarco Farr, who's here today, sitting in for sleep. Producer Emily's here. Producer Jorge on the wheels of steel.
I'm in.
Back at the station.
I'm here, too.
I said your name.
Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't.
What's wrong with you? Why are you so sensitive with me?
Wait, Ireland read? He read the song? Like
no,
he read it off?
No, he just rattled them off.
Because
off the
player's going to play, and the hater's going to hate.
See?
It's not a lot of lyrics. It's a lot of repeated stuff.
Because we're calling the radio station this last few days Swift 710. More than any other reason, because it seems to really annoy people. And anything that really annoys people, I'm ready to make it a bit. By the
wow.
way, it is the Waba Grill Lunch Hour on 710, Swift 710. Thanks to our friends at Waba Grill. You've got to try Waba Grill's new Asian-inspired Boom Boom Taco Trios with your choice of chicken, ribeye, steak, or shrimp. Visit your local Waba Grill location or order online for pickup or delivery at wabagrill.com. Waba Grill, eat smart, be healthy. Tommy Lamb, the chairman of the Fun and Games Department, is taking me back from practice. We're heading north. And we're stopping at a Waba Grill.
Nice.
Let's go. He's also going to be at the Taylor Swift concert tomorrow.
That's true.
I'm super excited for him. He's taking his little girls. It's going to be like a beautiful moment in their mind that they are going to love their dad for.
I love that you have become the guru of all things Taylor Swift show. That
we talked about yesterday. I'm a planner.
You are.
I want to give advice.
You are.
Best practices.
all of those things. When to do the bathroom break, DeMarco.
Wow.
Which costumes to wear. Which bracelets to have.
Yeah. She's.
Did you give Tommy any bracelet tips?
Didn't give him any bracelet tips, but I did give him, have water, two waters per girl is the best way to do it, because you are going to get thirsty because these girls are going to be singing every word of this song, and it's going to be like 3 hours long. It's going to be hot in there. So I was so thirsty by the end of that show. That was the main thing that I remember, besides obviously how good of a time I had.
Will Tommy have a good time? I know his girls will have a great time, and he'll have fun seeing them have fun, but will he enjoy the show?
I think he will admire the like view of it, the performance of it all, but I think the main thing I'm sure for him is seeing his girls have such a good
sure.
time. And I think that's the most important thing, I think, for any parent taking their kids to this concert, is seeing how much their kids have so much joy.
Yeah.
It's lovely.
And how much it costs.
And how much it costs. Hey.
He's the chairman of the Fun and Games Department. He's got plenty of scraps.
No. I'm not talking about him specifically. I'm saying that what Emily said is entirely true, but there is also that equation of, I want my children to have every experience in the world that they can have. I want them to have a great time. But there is a budget.
There's a limit. Yeah. That's an absolute limit.
There are some things that we have to
do. I don't know when Tommy bought these tickets.
Okay.
And when I bought my tickets, they were not as crazy as these resale prices. I'm going to put myself out there. It was less than $300. It was like $250. So, again, it's whenever he got those tickets, they can be affordable, but who knows?
Are you having second thoughts about not going tomorrow?
No, I'm okay with that.
You're okay with it?
I think that I personally just... I very much have everything done. I was with my friends last night, the ones that are going to go, my friend's fiance, and he is super excited, so I'm excited to see him go.
You've been to 8 AC/DC shows?
9. I take that
wow.
back. It was 9. Yeah, same set list. Never gets old. Never gets old.
Have we seen them all over the country?
Yeah, from St. Louis all the way back to the Bay Area. Nothing east past St. Louis. But yeah, they rock, man. You got to go see Angus Young. Or is he dead? Did he die? Angus is not dead.
I think I accidentally killed him on the air a few weeks ago.
No, Angus isn't dead.
He's still alive.
He was the second guy, right?
No.
The first guy.
Angus Young is the guitarist.
Yes.
Okay.
He's,
yeah,
as
Bon
far
Scott
as
died.
Oh,
that's
Brian Johnson
alive.
Took over.
Right. That's what
yeah.
I'm,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. So that when you asked me the question about going up and singing, that's another one.
So I was going to say, can you do, if she can do all the Taylor Swift lyrics, can you do a little AC/DC for us?
Every single one of them. Every single one of them. Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, yeah. See, I can't sing this. I would, but I can't sing it. Yeah. I can't agree with the lyrics.
Yeah, fair enough.
I'm old now.
Yeah, I get it. All right. So we're here at UCI. We're watching the Rams practice.
Yeah.
And right now, Stetson Bennett's out there on the field with the offense.
You think he's the future? You know, you think Stetson Bennett's the future? He's that guy when Matt Stafford says, or excuse me, Matthew Stafford. I keep trying to sell this, man. Four-syllable name quarterbacks, it's hard.
Matthew Stafford.
Yeah, say that on the rollout.
Stetson
Matthew Stafford
Bennett.
On the rollout, complete the Cooper Cup.
Stafford. Just go last.
Quickly,
names.
Matt Stafford's fast, but yeah, I mean, I just wonder when Matthew.
Since
Stafford's
you asked,
done,
I'm gonna give you my two cents on this. I love the Riz. Right, I like that he has charisma. I like talking about Stetson Bennett. I like when he came up here and talked with us on Sunday afternoon.
Got some gravitas.
He does. Yeah. He absolutely does. And look, when you've been a two-time national championship winning quarterback at Georgia in the middle of college football country, the most important college football.
Had to earn that spot.
Had to earn it and had to was a all of these things. He's got that I know what I'm doing
Kid's
thing.
Kid's got some stones. Forgive
for,
me.
For sure he does. He little, bro.
He tiny. He's a little guy. But I mean, when
he's little. He's
about the same size as Russell Wilson. I wouldn't
well,
be surprised.
Russell Wilson's thicker.
But
than
I wouldn't be surprised if Drew Brees, if he could eat a pita off Drew Brees' head. So there've been some small guys have been successful. So
and I'm not saying that it's the kiss of death, but what I'm saying is the fact that we all say, "Oh, there's Drew Brees, there's Russell." It's two guys.
Yeah.
In the history of the league that's been around a long time, and most of them are bigger guys. Not all of them.
True.
But it's just one of those things that you know, what are we 80 yards away from him or so, give or take, and he's a lot
you could
smaller.
Lose him behind
he's
the line of scrimmage.
Lot, and that's exactly right. Like when he's back there, if he didn't have that red jersey on, if he were in blue or white like everyone else, he'd be real hard to find.
Well, remember, you had Everett sitting here one day, and you don't have to be oak trees anymore in the National Football League. So that's kind of changed. Everything's out of shotgun now. So even if you're a little bit short, you can still be effective. To me, it's all about decision making. To me, it's all about gravitas. I told you, I loved everything about Baker Mayfield until the ball left his hand. I've been like, oh, my God, I'm not sure where that's going. But I love the way he was a leader. He had swag. Guys wanted to be like him. He was the homecoming king type guy.
No, Bennett has that.
Yeah.
Bennett, when he came up here, there's just that it's the walk. It's the sit here. It's the talk. There's just some guys that you're drawn to. There's some guys that just like, okay, I want to be on his team. He knows what's going to happen next. But this is a big man's league.
See, when I was fighting over with my cousins can't stand Matthew Stafford. They think he's not good.
They
think
like
he's
Super
old.
Bowl championships?
That's what I keep saying. But I'm like, the dude has been first team all everything since he was 8 years old. Everything.
Right.
The guy is a fantastic athlete. He really is. He's a leader. Guys love him. He inspires people. How can you not like him? Ah, well, I just like certain guys. But, yeah, I think Stetson Bennett has that same sort of characteristics. The only thing is, now you've got to translate it to this level. You've got to make good decisions with the football constantly and move the football down the field.
And this is not an indictment of him at all. This is just something that he benefited from.
Yeah.
But at Georgia, he was playing with all NFL guys against teams that were not all NFL guys.
True.
Right? His offensive line, those are NFL players. Those wide receivers, those are NFL players. That defense, those are all NFL
players.
The Matt
Leinart effect. How good are you really?
Then all of a sudden, now we're all NFL players.
Yeah.
Everybody on every team is an NFL player. Okay, now do it. And that's a real thing.
Well, that's the cool thing about watching this with Sean McVay, Matthew Stafford, and the backup quarterback, Stetson Bennett. Let's just take him. You get to learn. You get to sit, learn, watch, and understand this game. And by the time you're ready to play, you're going to be mentally ready to play this game because you've had great examples and a great coach. So that's why I say when Matthew Stafford is ready to say, I'm done, and he's been here 2 or 3 years, I wonder, are we looking at the future right now of L.A. Ram football?
There is something different about Stafford, though. You just watch him throw the ball relative to these other guys. And again, this is not disparaging of anybody else. This is one of the great arm talents of a generation. The throws that he can make are unlike just, you know, Josh Allen. There's probably one or two other guys that can do Mahomes.
Yeah.
But there are not a lot of guys that can make throws the way they
from every platform. Yeah.
Rams have a first-round pick for the first time in so long.
First time since Jared Goff.
Yeah. In this draft, wouldn't they want to take a quarterback in the first round?
Well, I mean, that means your season
you
was bad. Yeah, that means your season was bad and you're picking high. But, I mean, I don't think you're ever going to have a chance at one of those top flight guys because I don't think you're ever going to be that bad again. But, I mean, at some point, like,
it's too thin.
See, everybody wants to tank for that kid from USC.
Yeah, Caleb Williams.
Dude, really? You want to just throw away a season for a rookie? That's good business. That's smart. Throw it away for a guy you don't even know can play at this level.
Fair enough.
Because everyone thought Reggie Bush was going to turn this league upside down.
No one knows anything for sure.
Yeah.
There are very few Peyton Mannings or, you know, Cam Newtons or guys who say, okay, that's going to work for sure. You don't know for sure. Joe Burrow, you don't know for sure. But to answer your question, this throw away a season, that language is super negative. What if I proposed a different terminology for it.
Okay, go ahead.
What if I propose a strategic long-term plan for sustained success?
Wow.
Okay? Which means we got to go down a little
bit. That's like before, child technician instead of nanny.
Before we start coming back up.
Yeah,
and
okay.
So my strategic plan for continued long-term success means we need to get a franchise quarterback that's younger than in his late 30s. And, yes, the only way you get one of those guys is to be able to pick one of those guys because they don't become available. And to be able to pick one of those guys, I got to be damn near to the bottom. And it's a short-term backup for a long-term gain.
You can always trade picks.
You can't.
You don't have to tank a season. You can just trade an entire draft.
And I don't think you can take in football.
Yeah.
This isn't basketball where you can put a team out there and just sit. Guys. It doesn't work quite like that.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is if you're just telling me just throw it away, I don't like the sound of that. But you're saying let's think 5-year window or 10-year window, and if one of those years has to be a little bumpy, I'm listening. I'm listening.
Okay. I see where you're going.
Yeah.
I was at the game in Cleveland where the Rams blocked a kick to beat Cleveland in a meaningless game. And I was so happy as a broadcaster because we finally won. No one was happy. I said, what happened? We just lost Andrew Luck. I'm like, what?
Right. He was pretty good.
Right.
You know, there are some guys that just when you get your hands on them, you think that they're going to be
their special
difference maker.
Yeah.
Do you think Caleb Williams is one of those guys?
Look, that dude is fantastic.
Yeah.
He is. He is fantastic.
He's the right combination of things, right?
Yeah.
He's pretty good size, can move his feet, but he's not a run-first guy. He's a throw-first guy, but if you need me to move, I can.
It's still a question mark, but I'm not going to throw away an entire season for one guy. That just doesn't make any sense. Yeah, because there's no guarantee that guy's going to be the guy. You might be right back where you just left, even with him.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Or you get the guy.
He's ready to, he's ready to do it. Like,
you never know, right? You never know for sure. You do your diligence, but it's one of those, we got the dude. Like
right.
All of a sudden, look, and here's how fast it can change. Joe Burrow walks into Cincinnati, and they went from a punchline to, oh, snap.
This is true.
Contenders
career. Trouble.
And how many guys were drafted before Mahomes?
Yeah.
Sometimes you
get a little lucky.
Absolutely.
Sometimes you get a little lucky.
Yep.
Patrick Mahomes is the best. What is he, 10th? Something like that?
Yeah. My guy was bagging groceries.
Yeah.
And he's in the Hall of Fame. Come on.
I wonder. I've always wondered. But we'll talk about this coming up in a little bit, too. Like, is there another one? Are there more guys that they just need a damn chance? Do you just need a guy to do that? That's coming up in a little bit. Plus, we're going to talk with Rams wide receiver Puka Nacua. He's scheduled to join us as well. It's all coming up. It's Trav and Sleet. DeMarco's in for Sleet on 710 ESPN.
The black and gold dominated in their league's cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals. LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denny Bawanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Forget about it!
We'll be right back.
una mujer con la ilusión de
Never saw a heat warning before in my life. I'm like, heat warning? Bring your livestock in. Bring your pets in. Bring your plants in. It's going to be that hot. And I'm walking out the door.
To go play football.
Full gear. Like, wait a minute. What is wrong with this?
Hey, coach, you might want to check out this news broadcast.
Right.
To make sure that you're not going to take some of us out along
Nuts.
The way.
Nuts. Yeah.
So I would imagine, too, it's a lot different for where you are in your career. If you're Aaron Donald, it's like, all right, I still got to get through three preseason games from the sidelines, and then it's go time. Matthew Stafford, the same. Then it's more guys that, like a Joe Noteboom, who's, you know, I gotta get my
something
spot back.
To prove.
I got something to prove.
Yeah.
And then there's a, I don't know if I'm going to make this team or not.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's got to be all those different range of emotions going through it, just not knowing what's coming next in your life. You might be on this team. You might be on a different team. You might not be playing.
You may be working for UPS in a couple of weeks. Yeah, it's just how it goes. I mean, it depends on what type of camp you have. I wish I had one more week. Or I'm ready for this to be over 10 days ago. Cooper Kupp is ready to go. Aaron Donald is just about ready to go. So all this is just waiting for September. But you've still got to create the team around you. So there's a lot of guys still battling. Jordan Fuller, number four, I just watched him practice.
Mm-hmm.
He was a guy that kind of lost his job due to injury last year. So they went in a different direction. He's back. He's the starter again. He's a guy that loved camp this year. He got to play. He got to practice. He got to be a part of it. He's a leader again. He's a guy that loves training camp and is probably sad that it's over because this has been fun for him.
So Rams are wrapping up today at this part of camp. They obviously go back to Thousand Oaks and they continue to practice and get ready and everything else. But Hard Knocks debuts tonight, right, on HBO, and they're with the Jets this year. And it's kind of that inside look at training camp. And but it's, Emily, you'd worked on Hard Knocks briefly, right?
Yeah.
It's like 20-plus seasons old. It's been around a long time.
Yeah.
Is it a pretty good representation of what actually is happening? Do you get a sense of this is what the coaches' meetings are like? This is the pressure on the players? Because it's the same for
yes.
You have the star, you have the veteran, then you have the guy that may or may not make the team. You've got a coach, you got a general manager. It's the same formula. Is it pretty accurate?
Yeah, it is. That's the problem because some stuff doesn't need to be broadcast. And when you have Hard Knocks around, you kind of have to wait until the cameras leave to get that coaching point out or to say what you need to say to your teammate.
Like what?
Like whatever. It could be something whatever. Like
you're always on guard a little.
Like you blankety blank, you did this to me, I can't wait to get you tomorrow. You know, that's type of stuff. But when the cameras show up, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And then you have guys that start to act for the camera. Like you're really not that guy, but you're doing it just for the camera. You see what I mean?
Am I a bad guy that the second you said that I immediately thought of J.J. Watt?
What happened to Watt?
Just
because I like J.J. Watt. Hold on now.
When they had the Texans on Hard Knocks, And J.J. Watt is a Hall of Fame player.
Yeah.
J.J. Watt is a phenomenal guy, like all the money he raised from Hurricanes and all that. Like, he's a good dude, but that entire season of Hard Knocks felt like the J.J. Watt show because every time there was a camera, J.J. Watt was in front of
it. That's really him.
Okay.
That is really him. He's outsized, and He's kind of one of those energetic type guys. He never stops talking or moving. So that's really him. Yeah. I mean, but other people, guys that are getting cut and know they're getting cut, will put on a show. That's where stuff gets stupid.
What are the other guys? The other guy's got to be looking like, seriously, dude?
Exactly.
Like, really?
And you can't.
You know you're not even going to be here in a week,
so
right?
This guy's up here holding court, right? And he's got cameras around. And you want to say, boy, you know, shut up. But you can't because there's cameras around. You know what I mean? So it's
you were
weird.
Never on a team that had that, right?
No, not as a player. But yeah. Twice here with the Rams. So I saw it twice, and I see how tough. Like, you could be talking to your coach. I've seen this happen with players, and they're having an intimate one-on-one conversation, and they're getting deep about some stuff, and then all of a sudden they look up, there's a boom mic over their head.
Oh.
And then the whole conversation changes. So that moment needed to happen for that player to get better, and it just changed because there's a mic there. That's why. It's way too invasive.
This is Emily and mine's one of our favorite topics, that Aaron Rodgers in New York this year, and not the hard knocks portion of it necessarily, but just – he's obviously an incredible player, a Hall of Fame player, one of the best that's ever done it. But I'm fascinated by how this is going to work or not. Because
it's a tough division.
It's a tough division, and he's got this thing. Maybe it's just because it's true.
He loves tweaking people. He loves tweaking the media. He loves tweaking people. But the thing
you
about
think that's going to work there.
But the thing about it, I'm sure you guys know people that graduated from Berkeley. Don't you know other Cal grads?
Oh yeah,
they're all weird. They're all weird and strange. They are. But this guy's just got a heck of an arm. So I mean, imagine the smartest guy in the room that doesn't care to let you know he's the smartest guy. He's also one of the best quarterbacks on the planet. You can't get rid of him. You see what I'm saying?
Would you do a darkness retreat, DeMarco? If it would open up your mind.
I'd give it a shot. How long was he in there? 2 weeks?
That was not 2 weeks.
Well,
it
was supposed to be 2 weeks, I think, and it lasted a day or two.
I think I can give you 2 days, maybe 48 hours.
Okay.
After that, I might start freaking out, you know, but yeah.
But that's where you get the enlightenment once you start freaking out.
Okay, well, then I'm not going to be enlightened. Yeah.
No, I don't want to be enlightened. I don't want to.
Not that deep. Yeah.
I'm not interested in what's going on up there.
I'll just go to Vegas.
I'm fine. I'm trying to turn those voices down, not turn them up.
Yes.
I do not need.
But on the field, there aren't many I've seen, including Tom Brady. And I played against some of the greatest, the Hall of Famers. But on the field, watching this guy, I haven't seen many better
than Rodgers.
He's great. He's got a command of the offense. He knows what you're doing defensively. He's petty. You should have seen him go after Jalen Ramsey.
Petty is a great skill when it comes to athletes.
Oh, my God. He couldn't wait to get back at that dude.
Absolutely.
Dude, you're bigger than I thought. Look at you.
All right. So, as promised, as advertised, we are joined right now by Rams wide receiver Puka Nacua, joining us after their final training camp. What does it feel like to have it done? Last day of training camp. What does that feel like?
It's a huge relief. Felt good. It was to be out there under the sun and back out there with the boys is always a good time. So I'm excited and glad that I can rest a little bit for a quick second.
Sure. You're exactly the way I thought you'd be. Look, you're dirty. You're bleeding already. You're my type of guy, man. I mean, look, you dreamed about playing in the NFL since you were a kid, I assume, and here you are just went through a camp. I mean, that's got to be amazing for you.
Yes, sir. I'm extremely grateful, and it's been a blessing to be out there with some of the best to do it, and there's so much information being cut out, but it's been a blast to be able to learn from the best to do it. So I'm having a blast out here.
Puka, what's been the biggest challenge to come from the college game to the pro game, and you get thrown in with a team that's, you know, recently off a Super Bowl championship, and you're surrounded with guys like Aaron Donald and Sean McVay? What's that like?
You're running from Aaron Donald.
Literally running all the time, even in the locker room. Actually, it's scary. But just having so much fun. It's fast. The game is so much faster. The room for error is so much smaller, and the attention to detail is the precision from everybody is unreal, because you got to be on the same page, and because you think as good as number nine is, the guys on the defense who are trying to stop you are just as fast. They're breaking on the brakes just quicker than everybody. They're able to understand the concepts that we're running. So trying to be on my P's and Q's at all time in the run game, in the pass game, trying to understand it all.
You're going
to
be a big part of it all. You know, you got to explain. So I am a Husky. You were a Husky, and then you went to BYU. How did you get from Washington to BYU?
Out of high school, Coach Adams was my receiver coach who recruited me there. So and my family, my grandma was diagnosed with ovarian cancer in that 20 season after COVID. So I had the opportunity and was blessed with the opportunity to be able to transfer back home and be with my family during that time.
I wanted to be mad at you. I can't be mad at you. You know, how do you leave Seattle? But that makes sense, though. Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean,
to go back home.
But then here, and then you get here, and I don't know what your terminology was like at BYU or Washington, but then you're talking to Sean McVay, and he talks a whole nother language when he talks offense. That's got to be weird for you.
Oh, 100%. The first days when we got here to OTAs, it was sounding like a foreign language. I get in the huddle, and Matthew Stafford walked in, and I'm with Tutu and Van on the side of me, and he said the whole play, and I looked at them, and everybody broke the huddle, and I was like, there's no way that was English. Man. I missed every word he said. I'm like, I was just in the meeting. I'm like, I'm paying attention in the meetings. I thought I was, but obviously not. So trying to repetition is the mother of learning. That's what Coach McVay always says. So being able to rep it out, so it becomes easier as the day goes on.
So what do you do in that situation? Do you turn to Van and go, where the hell am I supposed to go? Like, how do you navigate through that moment?
Yeah, that one, I was like, I looked back, right back at number nine. I was like, I have no idea what's going on. And that sometimes is the best way to do it. You don't want to go out there because you get somebody hurt if you're going out there and not knowing what you're doing. So he'd prefer, I think, sometimes to be like, hey, I need to ask simply what the route is, where I need to be placed, and the exact alignment, because of the precision going back to how important it is. If I'm off 2 yards in my alignment, it can make a big difference in the play.
See, Trav, that's why I like D-line.
Yeah, go forward.
Even if I'm wrong, I'm right. Just get up the field, right? You know, just get up there and make something happen. Who did you grow up rooting for? Who did you grow up watching, football-wise?
Packers fan.
You're a Packers fan.
Aaron Rodgers.
Aaron Rodgers. We were just talking about him. Yeah, that is the smartest, weird, best quarterback I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I'd be his friend, but I'd love to be his teammate. How about that?
That would be cool, but I think being number nine's teammate is a lot cooler, too. It's been super fun.
Yeah. So you grew up, any receivers you tried to model yourself after?
Julio Jones and Mike Evans, the two bigger receivers of them, and Julio Jones, I think being able to be that big and get out of the breaks the way he did, and then Mike Evans, I think of somebody who's physical, as known as a big receiver in the run game, but takes that physicality in his route running as well.
Rams wide receiver Puka Nacua, join us here on Travis and Slee. DeMarco's in for Slee. From the moment that I've started following the camp this year and hearing people talk about the new players, every time your name is mentioned, they mention Robert Woods. That, have you heard that as much as I have, that people remind you, that you remind people of Robert Woods, who had an incredible career here in LA?
A little bit, not too much from over here, but watching the film, it's been a lot of seeing number 17 out there with Cooper Kupp. So I've heard it definitely a little bit.
I'm looking at you bigger than I thought. It looks like you wouldn't mind blocking.
Oh, definitely not. That's how you get the routes running.
See, I told you. Like, you love to hit and catch at the same time.
Yes, sir. It's all a part of it. I love the game of playing wide receiver.
That's not fair. See what I mean? See, you guys can't be tough and skill guys at the same time. Come on, that's not fair for us on the other side.
That's the best of both worlds.
Have you had a welcome to LA moment or anything like that since coming into town, since getting into camp, that, wow, not only am I in the NFL, but I'm in the NFL in Los Angeles with the Rams?
Nothing too yet. It's been hard, especially with the busy schedule that they have, they keep us pretty busy, so I feel like I've been locked in with ball for these 12 days that we've been out here for however how long. Somebody said happy Sunday the other day, and I was like, oh, it's
you
Sunday.
Say so.
I was like, you said it's Sunday? My fault. I didn't know.
Have you been to SoFi yet?
No, sir.
This is your first time going to SoFi?
Yeah.
Oh, this is going to blow your mind.
I can't wait. I've only heard the best.
What's the biggest stadium you've been in?
I think maybe Baylor University.
Baylor? Okay, this is not even close to what you're about to see.
Oh, man.
Yeah, and think about it. If you score enough, they all be chanting your name. Puka, Puka.
That's what I can't wait for.
Well, DeMarco's heard me say this before, and, you know, having covered the team for the last several years, when they opened SoFi, even now, several seasons into SoFi, every time you walk in there, it's like, you got to be kidding me. And I've been in there dozens of times at this point. Every time you and I see each other, it's like, can you believe this place? I'm always excited for somebody to go experience it for their first time.
Oh. Your face is going to be the size of this tent. Yeah. Think about that, right? Everything you dreamed about is about to come true. Isn't that amazing?
It is amazing.
Yeah.
Truly blessed.
And I have to say this. Do you think the hardest part is getting here? The hard part is to stay here. How bad do you want to be a football player? Like, in your heart, how much do you want to be a professional football player? I'm asking.
Oh, more than anything, this is what I've been dreaming for. So now that the opportunity is within my grasp, there's no chance I'm letting it go anytime soon.
And he's bleeding when he said that.
Yeah.
Right? See?
Well, he's your type of guy. Have you gotten a sense of how much, if any, you're going to play on Saturday?
No, sir, not yet. Whatever they need me to do, I love playing the game of football. I'm blessed to be here. And I can't wait. It's my first time in SoFi, so I got to make a good debut.
Absolutely. Puka Nacua, Rams wide receiver, joining us here on the final day of Rams.
What size shoe
camp.
You wear?
Yeah, I was going to say.
Look at this,
I'm a 14.
You're a 14. He's a receiver. That's not fair. Good God.
What do you got going over
13.
There?
13.
Okay.
See? 14. Size 14. He's a receiver. They're getting bigger.
You got to be able to put your foot in the ground.
Donald, your whole life? Come on, man.
How much have you gotten? How much time have you gotten to spend with Cooper Kupp, and how much have you been able to pick his
brain?
Oh,
yeah.
As much as he'll let me, I feel like I try to be in his back pocket. One of the best to ever do it. Oh, my gosh. And he's absolutely unreal. In the meeting room, in his preparation, in the training room, to the weight room, to everything on the football field, obviously, that you guys get to see. He's the best of the best, and the attention to detail. So I'm trying to follow his routine and pick up on the things that he'll let me. But
Puka, do you get the sense that that's the difference between the NFL and college football? It's everybody's a great athlete. Everybody's big. Everybody's fast. Everybody can do all these sorts of things. But the work that you put in, it's not just here, the study, the film, the conversations with other great players.
Yeah, I'd say definitely. And then, Coop has got one of the best body controls as a wide receiver, and the understanding of leverage and tempo that I think separates him from all of the people to do it. So trying to pick up on any cues that he'll let me, and always watching number 10 film, always.
I've never seen a guy more aptly named than Tutu. Tutu Atwell. Yeah. I mean, the dude is just so blindingly fast, but, I mean, he's not that big.
And you'd be surprised. Sometimes you put hands on him, and then he's being physical enough to throw you by, and he's fast enough. You blink, he's out of there.
He's tougher than you think.
Oh,
yeah.
100%.
Amazing. And I told Travis, watching you guys do the red zone, when you and Benny Skoranek are on the field at the same time, oh, my God, that's scary. Somebody's getting their head knocked off.
Some big bodies flying. Number 18 is not scared to hit anybody.
Is that something you learned? Is that something you just always liked to do? Because
Did you play safety in high school? Safety, DB?
A little bit.
Okay.
Yeah. I like playing on the offensive sidebar, scoring touchdowns with the guy passing the ball. It's a lot easier.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, right? There are some people that get off on hitting people, looking at you,
of course.
Marco. And yes. Then there are other guys that, you know what, I'd rather run around you, past you, and I want to score the touchdowns as opposed to driving someone in.
Yeah, but actually as a receiver, there's nothing more satisfying than like catching a nice route perfectly, catch, tuck, and turn, and then seeing a DB at the goal line. Just, oh, yeah, I'm about to run right through you, man. That's a cherry on top.
See? Same mentality. My idea of beauty is the blindside shot. That's a perfect 10 for me. Yeah, absolutely. No doubt.
So what are you looking forward to? Once the season gets started, obviously you got the game, but just the life in the NFL. Have you gotten past any of the football part of it and just living the life of an NFL player?
Trying food spots. There's so much food out here compared to what there is in Utah, so I'm trying to hit every food spot. I ask everybody where they go, what's their favorite eat. So whatever you guys can put me on, I'll try it for sure.
Just don't diss In-N-Out.
Oh, yeah. No, they got you In-N-Out in Utah.
Okay. Sorry,
okay, yeah, I'm In-N-Out guy, yeah.
So if you're a cheeseburger guy, I'll give you one right now. It's the Apple Pan. It's on Pico, just, what would that be, just north of Westwood Boulevard. It's been there since the 40s. It's an old-school little U-shaped counter.
Great
cheeseburger
burger.
Spot. You'll be very happy.
Count me in. Just don't tell our nutritionist.
Okay.
Our secret.
My man.
Puka Nacua, Rams wide receiver. Congratulations on your first camp. We look forward to watching you.
Appreciate that, guys.
You were a Husky and a Cougar. That's impossible.
Back with more from Rams training camp. It's Travis Slee. DeMarco's in for Slee on 710 ESPN. Hey, if you get hurt in an accident, you need to call the accident attorneys at Sweet James. 1-800-9-MILLION. That's the number. 1-800-9-MILLION. 1-800-900-0000. Because if you're hurt in an accident, it's confusing, it's scary, you're going to be hurt, and you're trying to figure out what to do next. That's when the insurance company is going to come your way, and they're going to try to get it done as quickly and cheaply as possible. That's where Sweet James has your back. He's not going to let you take on those insurance companies.
The black and gold dominated in their league's cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Galaxy, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16, led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bawanga, versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight. Pre-game begins at 7 p.m. on 710 ESPN and the ESPN LA app.
Yeah. Oh.
Black and gold dominated in their League's Cup debut, putting up a club record 7 goals.
Galaxina, what a goal!
Now, LAFC go marching into the round of 16,
led by Carlos Vela and Denis Bouanga,
versus Real Salt Lake and the return of Chicho Arango and Danny Musovski. LAFC collide with RSL tonight.
Pre-game begins at
on that. He's bleeding, he's dirty, he's enthusiastic, he loves football. He's your kind of guy.
That is terrifying as a defender.
Yeah.
He's going to knock you out and love doing it. May help you up. But he's going to do everything that is required of this offense of that position. So it's not just about catching passes. It's about being a part of the run game. You see how big he is and how willing he is. So there's going to be some Niner fans that really hate him coming soon.
And not only his goals, he seems like a really, like, awesome young man too.
Yeah,
clearly he like went home to be with his grandmother, all that good stuff. It seems like he's really like a really good
grounded
guy.
Yeah, absolutely grounded.
I want to go back to something you said. He might help you up. You've watched Quarterback on Netflix?
Oh yeah.
Okay, when I forget who the defensive player, Cousins, they're playing against the Commanders, he drops back, he lets the ball go and just gets walloped, just hits right in the chest. You hear him at the ground go, and he's laying there, he's like, I can't breathe. And then the Washington defender goes up to him, pats him on the back, goes, "You'll be all right."
You'll be all
right. And just starts walking away. Yeah. Did you ever do something like
absolutely
that?
Absolutely. Like, you'll be all right. Yeah, shake it off. You're good. Yeah. Rub some dirt on it. You'll be all right.
It was so cold because it wasn't meant to be cold, which made it so much colder. Like,
No, it was meant to be cold.
This is what we do. You stand there, I hit you, and then we go do it again.
Right. Sheepdog and the coyote. This is how we do. We punch in and punch out. I was telling people, I was watching with my wife and kid, like, why does Mahomes always talk to the guys and say, "Good job"? Yeah. Well, he's trying to humanize himself. Because when you go into a game, quarterbacks aren't people. They're targets. So the more they talk, the more you realize this is a guy that has a family.
I think it was against the Rams. They showed
Wagner.
Bobby Wagner.
Yeah.
I don't want to say he pulled up because I'm not going to put that on Bobby, but he could have hit him. And he didn't.
It's a pull-up. By rights, he could have at least lunged at him.
Yes.
But he let him. He gave him a pass.
And Mahomes went to him and said, "Hey, man, appreciate you."
The nicest guy in the world was Dan Marino.
Really?
Dan would talk, "Hey, how's your family? How's your dad?" He'd remember you.
Yeah.
And he'd talk. And when you get in those situations with him where it could be like pull up or let him have a pass, you'll let him walk.
Mm.
Now, you go get him and sack him and hit him. But if you have an opportunity where he's giving himself up and you can take a shot, you might not.
That show is so fascinating to me because they picked the three. They picked mega star.
Yeah.
Best guy in the league. They picked a guy who's kind of almost the definition of the middle of the pack.
Yeah.
A guy that when he's good, he's really good. Kirk Cousins had a good team, good season. And then another guy who's holding on by his fingernails to stay in the league.
Drama.
And you could tell, like, Mahomes is just walking around with just charisma just pouring off of him. Just this, like, I own the universe. Welcome to my world.
Right.
And Cousins is – part of it is just who he is. Very humble and aw shucks.
Yeah.
And we're going to go out there and do our best.
He hides his trophy room.
And you could tell Mario's like, "Yeah, I'm going to get fired today."
Yeah, right.
Yeah, like you could just, it's just coming off.
Town to Vegas.
Baby, don't unpack.
And you could feel it from his teammates. Like the Falcons teammates are like, "Nah, bro, you're not even going to be here for a while."
And I rooted for Mariota. He just makes too many mistakes. But, I, you know, I went into that whole show completely out on Kirk Cousins.
Really?
No, absolute no. And then after, I'm like, you know what? He's not that bad.
Hard not to like
him. I was all in on the Cousins train at the end. I was like, is this going to make me love Kirk Cousins?
He's coming very hard not to like. For what we were talking about with Coach McVay, too. You know why?
Yeah.
It's authentic.
Yeah.
That's who he is. You can like it or not like it, but he's not playing a character. He's a corny Midwestern dude.
That's him.
And he just plays the role, and he's a good quarterback, and you could tell his teammates loved him.
You can smell phony from a mile away.
Absolutely. Yep. Shohei Ohtani last night. It's not a Travis Lee show if I don't talk about Shohei Ohtani for a couple of minutes.
You should talk about him more.
He had a double. He had a single. He stole a base. He scored a run, and the Angels lost. Wow. Like, at some point, he's got 9 wins on the mound. He's got one of some of the best pitching numbers in baseball, even though his pitching numbers are a little bit down from what they've been. He's the most prolific offensive player in the entire league. He leads the league in triples and home runs, RBI, the whole thing. I can't help but have incredible amount of empathy for him, knowing what it must be like to go into that locker room, that look, and say, guys, I'm doing stuff that's never happened before. Can I get a little bit of help around here?
Wow. What did he do again? A double?
He had a double, a single. He scored a run, and he stole a base.
Did the run get home? RBI double?
He scored on that.
He scored on that, and that took the score to what?
I believe it tied the game when he scored.
Gave him a chance to win, and they still couldn't get it done.
Yeah,
wow.
They gave up 6 runs in the top of the ninth.
Okay, I'm with you.
They'll lose their 7th in a row.
I'm with you. But just appreciate what you're seeing, because I don't think you'll ever see this again.
No.
It's been him
not
and
like
Babe
this.
Ruth.
I think what will happen, and by the way, and you're not wrong, DeMarco, Babe Ruth only pitched for a very brief period of time. The Ohtani has already done more on the mound
on that.
Than Ruth has. Now, he's got a ways to go to be Ruth offensively.
Okay.
But what you're going to see, I believe, is you're going to see, and I'll just use these guys because they're local guys, you're going to find a guy that's Chris Taylor at the plate and Tony Gonsolin on the mound. Which, by the way, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But what you have now is you have Garrett Cole and Aaron Judge in one guy. That's what you have.
Unbelievable.
You have that combination.
And also, we keep on saying that we appreciate it right now as you're seeing it, but like, we kept on saying that, like, he can't repeat this year after year. He could potentially do this longer than we even think that he could.
See, I'm in that group. This can't go on forever. No one can be this good.
Yeah, you never know,
physically,
right?
Physically, how
we
can you do that?
We keep on saying that, but he keeps doing it over and over again.
How can you be physically that good where you can pitch and hit every day?
You're seeing the what you're talking about, you're seeing it when he's on the mound. At the plate, he still looks 10 out of 10.
Yeah.
On the mound, where he wasn't 10 out of 10, it's like an 8.5.
It's dropping off. Okay.
And it's still really, really good, but it's not that. Because, of course, it's not. He's got to go take 5 at-bats tonight.
So, is there a day where he stops pitching?
Probably not. Not unless
okay, so
an
he pitches all the way. This is going to it's going to be the same pitching, hitting show throughout his career. Okay, I thought at some point he may stop pitching and just
he's gonna
focus
get paid
on,
like it.
I mean, get 2 full-time checks, right?
Why not?
I'm as good as Justin Verlander. Okay, that's $45 million. I slug like Aaron Judge. That's what. Tell me why I don't get 90.
That's a great point. Yeah.
That's where, if I'm the agent, that's where I'd
start. Your argument against?
Yeah, yeah. Tell me why that doesn't add up in your world.
Right, and put it on camera.
Exactly. And the answer is, we can't pay. That's not my problem. That's your problem.
Yeah.
You know, well, we got to put good. You'll
trade me to somebody who can then.
They'll figure it out. It's going to happen. It was today in 1992, August 8th, 1992. The Dream Team, the original Dream Team, won the gold medal at the Barcelona Olympics.
Still the best basketball team I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I don't know if the world was, you know, the rest of the basketball world wasn't as good, but to me, that was the best basketball team you'll ever see.
Refresh me again. Who was on the team?
So it was Jordan,
because I wasn't born yet, remember?
Magic, David Robinson, Patrick Ewing, Scottie Pippen, who else? But John Stockton, Karl Malone. Christian Laettner.
Yeah, Christian Laettner, yeah.
Yeah, Christian Laettner
and
was
Christian
the one.
Laettner.
Not Shaq, Christian Laettner.
Yeah.
Which is like, okay, that's fine. Shaq would have fit in a little bit better.
A little bit.
Shaq would have been that guy. But you're right. Like, watching international basketball where it is now, like that team against an international team now would be far more interesting for no other reason.
Yeah.
Those games weren't competitive.
It was ridiculous.
It was – who did they decide to basically
break? It was American dominance at its best.
Yeah, and they just absolutely steamrolled guys along the way. The most interesting thing about that, and they did it – I think it was NBA TV. They did a documentary about the 92 Dream Team, and the most competitive part of that entire portion was when they would scrimmage each other.
Practicing, yeah.
When Jordan would have a team and Magic would have a team. And they would go at it like it was World War III.
Wouldn't you?
Because both of those guys are maniacs when it comes to competition.
Wouldn't you love to be in that room?
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Those grainy-ass videos of those things are so fascinating to me. Like, I would watch entire practices of those guys going at
it. Like, we had those on this show. Like, going back to see, like, a Doors concert or something you missed. I would want to go back to those practices. Yeah, and just be a fly on the wall.
It shows how far the international play has come to since 1992, that on a USA versus the world team right now, if we had all the best guys, would be incredibly competitive. Back then,
yeah,
not at
all. I still think we would win.
I think we'd be the favorite, but yeah. I don't know if we'd win.
I mean, they have Jokic, they have Luka, they have...
Are they on the same team?
No, here's the difference. If you did an international all-star team...
Oh,
USA versus the world.
But if, USA against, if you just did USA against Slovenia or...
Yeah.
That
but an international team from all over the world. Oh, my God,
Embiid, Jokic, and Luka are all on the same team.
Who's on our team? LeBron.
Well, you got LeBron. You got
Curry.
You got Curry. You've got...
Jason Tatum.
John Morant. You got Jason Tatum.
Still taking us.
Yeah.
I'm still taking us. Yeah.
But it would be close. It would be closer.
It'd be in the fourth quarter.
And we've had the past couple years have been dominated by international MVPs. Like, our MVPs of the league have been international players for so long. It is just interesting to me to see how far it's come. But, you know, it's still interesting to see it.
Who's coaching them and who's coaching us?
Kerr is coaching the American team.
Kerr with the guy from Gonzaga, Mark Few, and Spoelstra.
Who's coaching them?
I'm not sure.
If you had to pick an international world, if it's Popovich, we got problems.
It might be Pop.
We got problems.
It might be Pop. Although he was the head coach of Team USA for so long, he might not want to do that.
This is true.
Okay. Yeah. By the way, Reeves showed out last night for
he
Team
killed
USA.
It.
Yeah, it was really cool. It's just, I was watching it. I was actually doing trivia last night, and I looked up in the screen. I was like, oh, that looks like Austin Reeves. It's so weird to see him in a non-Laker uniform, because I obviously wasn't super paying attention to him when he was playing college. So it's just like, oh, there's our guy going out there, Taylor Swift's maybe boyfriend or whatever.
Okay, everything's Taylor Swift.
It's funny because I think we've finally gotten to the point, because to Emily's point, against Puerto Rico last night, he was great. We're done being surprised that he's good, right?
Yeah.
Like, he's just good.
We're over that now.
There's always a guy that, wait, is he good? And it's like, yeah, I think he's pretty good. And it's like, well, is he really good?
Yeah.
Austin Reeves is just a good player. There's no more, we all know he's good. And he goes out there and smashes guys. It's not a huge surprise.
Cooper Kupp. You're still surprised Cooper Kupp is good?
No.
But people.
At this point.
Or Christian McCaffrey. Yeah. You're still surprised he's good by now? Yeah. You might want to let that go. Yeah, he's good.
No, he's sneaky good. No, he's really good. He's just good.
You want to talk about Aaron Boone?
Absolutely.
And his meltdown?
So, I don't know about you. I love a good major league ejection. Because we don't get them very much anymore, right? Because there's instant replay, you don't get those umpire-manager confrontations where guys are screaming and yelling at each other.
Yeah.
Tommy Lasorda was a legend at it. Billy Martin was a legend.
I go to sleep watching those. They're great.
They're unreal.
Yes.
We got a pretty good one last night. Aaron Boone, the manager of the Yankees, gets tossed out, arguing a ball and strike call. Laz Diaz was the home plate umpire, and I'm a baseball dork, so forgive me here. Laz Diaz is arguably the worst umpire in Major League Baseball.
Even worse than Angel Hernandez.
Well, when Angel Hernandez, they've kind of just disappeared him. He doesn't even participate anymore.
Right.
But if Angel stayed to the farm.
If Angel Hernandez came back, Laz drops to number two.
Okay.
But you're in the right ball. Okay. You're in the right neighborhood.
I got you.
Called third strike. Laz Diaz bangs him out, and it was a strike. Like, you know, the box, it wasn't even close.
It was a strike.
But Boone had enough. He loses his you-know-what. He goes out there, and he's going. And then he did a thing that was so great. He imitated Laz Diaz's strike three call, because Diaz does this thing where he's kind of in a crouch, and then when he calls him, he bangs him out up high, like up like here, like like around his head. And Boone imitated him doing his call.
I got to see this.
Terrific.
I got
to just terrific, because it went from – you stink at your job to you can't even do good theater. It was tremendous.
Oh, yes. Boone is funny. He's one of the good ones to get ejected.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's a good one.
Have you ever seen him do his batting stance guy thing?
No.
So he can – because keep in mind, his grandfather played in the big leagues.
Yeah.
His father played in the big leagues. His brother played in the
big leagues. He can do any batting stance.
You name
I've seen
any
this.
Player from like 1975 until now, like – Kenny Lofton, and he turns around, and he's got Kenny Lofton. Give me Pedro Guerrero, and he's got Pedro Guerrero.
I have seen
in.
This. I thought you meant getting ejected.
No.
Oh, okay. I have seen this before.
I don't know if he can do every umpire, but he did a little SDS thing.
I go
like
to
this.
Bed watching Lou Piniella get thrown out.
Lou Piniella was a lunatic.
Oh, my God. I love it. I love it. Absolutely.
He was probably at the Mariners when you were at UW.
Correct. Yes. I went into the dugout, into the clubhouse with him. My cousin played for him.
Oh, no kidding.
I didn't know anything about Lou Piniella. I went out of that room knowing everything about Lou Piniella.
Intense man.
Oh, my God.
Intense
really intense.
Guy.
Super intense.
He yelled at me one time when a million years ago when I was producing, and we would try to get in. We would just randomly cold call people in their hotel rooms. Like, you just, and believe it or not, just about everybody was listed under their own name. I got Alex Rodriguez on the phone in his hotel one night.
Wow.
So I called Lou Piniella, who's, I believe, the manager of the Reds at the time. And he lit me up for calling him in his hotel room. It was great. Him, Derek Bell, one of your former teammates, Kevin Green, screamed at me.
Really?
Yeah.
The linebacker?
Yes.
For calling him?
Yes. Yeah.
You should be yelled at if you call me in my hotel room before a game.
I didn't know. I'd just go call these guys. All right, I'll start
calling. You were doing a job. Yeah.
And I, you know, half of the people would just hang up. Quarter would say yes, and a quarter would call me names.
There you go.
And
see?
Lou Piniella was in the second.
It's like selling stocks.
Yeah. Still a little little super crosstalk right now.
ESPN AM 710 Los Angeles. KRDC AM 1110 Pasadena, Los Angeles.
K256CX 99.1 FM Pasadena, Los Angeles.
It's the greatest segment in L.A. sports radio history. Radio history.
Oh, my God.
When the shows come together for magic on the radio.
It will only grow stronger. Super Crosstalk.
Are we ready for Mason and Ireland to join Travis and Slee?
Super Crosstalk begins.
Super Crosstalk presented by In-N-Out Burger. In-N-Out. That's what a hamburger is all about.
It's time for Super Crosstalk.
Woo, 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 woo. So, John Ireland back in the studios at LA Live. John, are you there?
Yeah. You got me here, Jorge?
We got you.
Mace is here, too.
Yep.
Okay.
Last day, when I say last day of camp, DeMarco, does a smile come over your face like Christmas is here? Like,
oh my God,
camp when you were playing?
Ear to ear. I told Travis we had to be called the St. Louis 500. As soon as camp ended, get in your cars and drive back as fast as you can. Absolutely.
Now, when I first started covering NFL training camp, this was in the 90s with the Chargers. They did two-a-days. Do they still do that?
No. Two-a-days are out.
Okay, but you had to do two-a-days, right?
Absolutely.
And you would hit both times.
Yeah, we go padded for 3 hours both practices. That's been kind of legislated out for player safety. So no one goes two-a-days anymore.
DeMarco was saying earlier, Ireland, that he does not think that the way that training camp is run right now, that when you were playing for the Rams with Dick Vermeil, that these guys would make it through a camp.
You know, and I'd even say maybe even Aaron would struggle
yeah.
what we went through. I mean, it was absolutely brutal. 2 days, twice a day, 3 hours per practice in pads, and we were banging both days or both practices in the heat. I mean, it was absolutely ridiculous. Player safety did not exist back then. Concussions were funny. Yeah.
I covered a Houston Oilers training camp in San Marcos, Texas, and it was 99 degrees with 98% humidity, and they were running two-a-days.
Yeah, crazy. I mean, that's what they used to think. I kid Vermeil all the time, and he really gets upset by it, but they used to think that's how you make good football players. You have to bang the lactic acid out of each other to become good. There's other ways to do it. Yeah,
I'd like to see the science behind that. Right. I don't know if there's a lot of sound science there. Mace, how was the show last night?
Show was great.
Did you make it for the whole thing?
I made it for the whole thing. It was worth it. I thought she was spectacular. I don't know how she played for as long as she did.
And 44 she went, songs.
Yeah, she went three and a half hours. I think she would have gone another hour if there were no curfew. It's a spectacular show to look at. She is just a great, great performer.
I was trying to think, you guys, of, I mean, this show she's putting on. She's doing six shows, 75,000 people at each show. Everyone, I mean, people are coming from all over the state.
Oh, yeah.
All over the country, really. If they can get their hands on tickets to get into this thing. I think it is the biggest concert tour to hit Los Angeles since after Thriller came out.
Mm. Right.
The Jackson 5 went on a thing they called the Victory Tour.
Oh, yeah,
tour.
I was at the Victory Tour.
And
it wasn't great.
It was impossible to get tickets. They put it in big stadiums, yep. But it's all anybody was talking about.
Yeah.
And this Taylor Swift, like, Beto was in here. Beto doesn't like Taylor Swift. He goes, yeah, I'm so sick of Taylor Swift.
I'm so sick of
it. Right, right. But, you know, what he's not getting is everybody is consumed by it.
Yeah,
I mean, you can't go to Starbucks. You can't go to a gas station. It's the
Emily
biggest
was
event
saying
of the summer.
That when she went to Disneyland on, what was it, Friday, Emily?
Yeah, Friday.
That she went to Disneyland on Friday afternoon, and that half the crowd at Disneyland was decked out in Taylor Swift stuff.
Yeah.
I think it's the biggest concert event in 20 years.
Well, let me tell you something. Emily, you're there. When is she going to let this thing go with Jake Gyllenhaal?
Mace, this is every day you do this with me.
She left a sweater or a scarf at Jake Gyllenhaal's sister's house. It's a metaphor.
There is no scarf. It's a metaphor.
She did the full 10-minute song.
Yes.
God bless her.
And it's one of the best songs in the whole set.
Emily, see if you agree with this.
Okay.
I think that she receives more adoration than any performer I have ever seen. It is like the last night of Kobe's career.
Mm-hmm.
She just like bats her eyes and walks a little fancy, and the entire place goes crazy.
Oh, walks a little fancy.
Let me reenact my favorite part
of that, by the way.
Let me reenact like one of her intros to her song. So her third song of the show is called "The Man," and it's talking about if I was a man, it'd be so much easier, whatever. But she says, "Oh, LA, you're making me feel so good. You're making me feel so strong. Like I could do anything." And then everyone's like screaming at the top of their lungs. And they're like, "Oh, it makes me feel like the man." And then she goes into the song "The Man." And it's, again, it's so corny. It's so cheesy. But we eat it up. It's great.
Although I will say this, Em. Corny works for her.
Oh, totally
yes.
Does.
Earnest
and corny.
Some people.
It's her audience.
She's the Kirk Cousins of musicians.
Right. Wow. No, that's Trav. Yeah. That is a great analogy. Corny works for Kirk Cousins.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think she's more successful than Kirk Cousins.
Corny worked for Tim Tebow.
Ah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it just for some people, Kurt Warner, DeMarco, a little corny. And it kind of worked. A
little bit. We were just talking, but it's genuine. It's really him.
Yeah, it's got to be real.
She's a theater kid at heart. I think she really, really is a theater kid, and that comes across really strongly, especially in Tolerate It, where she does this entire reenactment of a dinner, and it's just like, we could just tell Taylor Swift missed out on her high school experience, and she really wanted to be in dramas.
What did you think of the reenactment of the dinner, Mace?
I thought the dinner looked delicious. I wanted to. By the way, there were a couple of guys who tried to bring beers up to Taylor Swift. I'm like, guys, have we learned nothing from Cardi B? Do not approach the stage.
Did they
beers?
Get dropped?
They did not get dropped. They got ushered very firmly.
Yeah, very briskly firmly taken
because
away.
Because there's already been an issue at the Philadelphia show where the security guard was being too rough with a fan, and Taylor, in the midst of her singing, was like, "Stop, she's not doing anything." So Taylor would notice if she was even around that happening, and she's made it very clear to the security guards that she does not want people treated like that, apparently.
Like, not going to throw mics at people like Cardi B?
Yeah. Do you think you have to be a jerk to get where Taylor Swift is?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
I don't. Well, define.
I don't think. Well, okay. There's a very famous, I talk about all the time, famous music documentary about the Eagles.
Right.
And you don't have to be a jerk, but someone on your behalf has to be a jerk. Don Henley, halfway through that documentary, goes, "Let's get one thing straight. Irving Azoff is an a-hole. But he's our a-hole."
Right.
So she needs somebody to negotiate her position, you know, like her second life. But she, I think, just kind of shows up and performs. She did a thing, Emily, you probably heard about this. She did a thing where she held a drawing and she invited 24 of her biggest fans to her apartment. And they all came over and watched movies in her apartment.
Mm-hmm. Really?
And like three or four of them slept over.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, she just
slept
over at Taylor's house.
This is how she creates her like cult of personality, essentially, if we're going to go there. So she's creating this idea that any one fan could be plucked out of the crowd and be her best friend. And so by inviting 25 people over to your house, that's putting your entire fan base of millions of people being like, what if I'm one of those 25 people? Then you get more intense, and because she scours the internet, and either her or her team will like your tweet, like your post, all that stuff. It's a very ingenious way of subtle marketing and subtle creation of that kind of rabid fan base that I think will be studied long term in like PR books.
Mace, how many people are you inviting to your house?
Yeah, Trav, the other thing about her is we talked about this in our late crosstalk yesterday. There is this huge battle going on right now in the advertising world about how do you get to teenagers and young adults. How do you get to people age 16 to 28. Because these kids now don't watch TV.
Right.
They just don't. I mean, Jeff, you have kids in that demo.
Yep.
You know, they consume media now on their phones, on their iPads, on their computer. They're not sitting around like Mace, you and I on Thursday nights would watch Friends, Seinfeld, you know, all that stuff. These kids and she has broken the code. They all come to her.
Right.
So, I mean, she's going to have a very – I think she's the next Barbara Streisand. I think she'll be until she's 60.
We were trying to come up with the person that she's going to age into, right?
Yeah.
That Barbara Streisand's good. I said Cher, right? Somebody that's been around a long time that puts on a show that has a very defined fan base that are incredibly loyal to her. Is that a good comp, Em? Would you sign up for Cher?
And Beyonce is running a parallel
race
with her.
Beyonce is right there.
Yeah, those two have found a way to tap into this market that nobody else can seem to tap into.
It's because they reinvent themselves all over and over again. And they have their, if they're not going to say it, they have eras. They go through the same thing. They reinvent themselves each time they go out and put out new music.
I'm
actually surprised, Emily, that she's 33 and she's never been married, right?
No, she's not been married.
Yeah, so, I mean, she keeps – maybe it would be bad for her brand because she writes about all her breakups. But, you know
– Seems to be a common theme.
She shouted out that last boyfriend in the middle of that thing.
Yeah.
Did you hear it, Emily?
I heard it. I think that she – if you listen to the song, there's a song called Paper Rings. I think that she may have wanted to get married and he did not. So that
to this current boyfriend or to a previous one?
Previous, most recent, though, she dated for 6 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do we have any insight? Yeah, it's because – I mean, I – sign up for that seems like an interesting run.
He did not want to be in her spotlight.
Okay, well, think about it. If I mean, what that guy is auditioning for, the guy who ends up with Taylor Swift in the long term, is he gets to be Stedman.
Yeah, I'm okay with that too.
Oh, no,
right?
No. Yeah, I can't do that.
I bet Stedman doesn't have a lot of bad days. True.
I would pay to be Stedman,
of course.
DeMarco, wouldn't you?
I don't know, there, John. I mean. You're always known as Stedman.
Fine.
Right.
But I'm going to go eat. I'm going to have a nice dinner at the end of the night.
I'm living in Montecito in a compound.
Right. Right. I'm a member of the Valley Club. I'm eating in nice restaurants. I'm going to go.
If you're looking for a Stedman, where do I sign?
Yeah. Absolutely.
You know, Emily, if I'm not mistaken, she dates only famous people, right? I don't think she's dated anybody who's not.
She has only dated someone on the same level of famous she has. I think the most least known quote unquote person she's dated was probably a Kennedy. And
wow.
So that was way back when. So, yeah, she's
like
only really
Kennedy,
dated other
people. Like the Kennedys?
Well, this is the world you're running in. So she dated someone in the Kennedy family.
Yeah.
And then she bought a compound in Hyannisport.
Oh, that's right.
Wow.
You know, just that's how she rolls.
That's aggressive. That's like trying to enter. Like, the Hyannisport is for the Kennedys.
Right.
That's their hang.
Emily, do you know if she still has it?
I don't think so. She has the house in Rhode Island. It's the big house.
It was probably too soon. Like, it was too soon for her to buy a compound in Hyannis.
Yeah.
She can buy whatever scared the guy off.
That's bringing your mom and dad to dinner on the second date.
Yeah, it is.
It was Kennedy. It's one of the grandsons. But, yeah. She's only really dated musicians and actors. So the two areas she's been in.
I'm going to change this up real quick.
All in all, I'm so glad I did it. It was such a great night. I love a lot. Watching people sing with the songs. Everybody knows every lyric, and you look around and there's middle-aged, well, there's
yeah,
women.
Yeah, they say the ages are like 6 to 60.
There's teenagers, there's little girl. I mean, they know every single word.
Were you singing, Mace?
Song.
Were you singing a lot?
I do not. I am not a true Swiftie. I don't know the lyrics. I know I've got a blank space, and I got your name. That one I know. I'm going to play. I know that one also.
So you're 19.
Haters are
going to
hate
the lyrics. Yeah, exactly. Gonna hate.
Like, so what do you do? You just stare at the video screens? Like, I need the Steve Mason experience at the show.
So we went with two of our friends, Morgan and Sarah, who were both fantastic and gigantic Swifties. They knew every single word. They gave me this bracelet I was supposed to wear, which was
did you decline?
Bracelet. No, I put it on. And I'm like, what the
they're your friends, Mace.
I'll play
you could have traded it.
Games. Yeah. I could have. You're right. I saw, in fact, last night I saw one of our regular listeners who works in guest relations there. His name is Michael Antonio, a great name. And he looked at me like, you've got these bracelets on, and you've got this thing that lights up on one hand, and you've got a snake ring, and you've got all this stuff. You're very odd, Steve Mason. You're very odd. So, but Michael Antonio, great guy. I thought, were you on the floor, Emily?
No, I was in the 200 sections.
Walking up from the floor was ridiculous. Oof. It was just like turn after turn after turn. That stadium is not built.
Must be a hard life, Mace.
Well, you come in on what, like the seventh level? That's the weird thing about SoFi is you come in and you're near the top of the stadium. You got to get all the way down to the floor. That's what you get for being a big shot and having good seats.
And then you walk like six turns of ramp to get down to the field, and then six levels of ramp to get back up. But completely worth it.
Like the visuals?
If you haven't seen it, go see it. What's that?
Did you like the visuals, Mace?
I loved the visuals. They were great.
How was the fancy walking?
The fancy walking was unbelievable.
She was strutting.
I thought this was her best fancy walking I have ever seen. Because really, that's in lieu of dancing, she fancy walks.
Is she not a dancer, Em? Is that not
she
her?
She dances a little bit, but she's gangly. She has like really unproportionate limbs, and I feel like she is a little clumsy, so I don't think that she dances all the time. So she does do some fancy walking. She struts. She does some minimal choreography, but her dancers are amazing.
We've invented a term here.
Fancy walking. Look,
since I heard you say it yesterday, Mace, I think I've repeated it 100 times since then.
Oh, yeah.
It's my favorite thing.
One clip from the concert, you're like, she is.
Cooper Kupp walks into the end zone.
I can't even tell you the last time that I saw like a Taylor Swift clip or anything, but the second you said it, I knew exactly what you're talking about. Exactly what she does.
Her moves, exactly.
You got to tell JB that Cooper Kupp can
fancy walk into the end zone.
When he scores a touchdown.
That might be Matthew Stafford.
By the way, is he okay to fancy walk right now?
He'll be fine. He doesn't need to practice right now. Just be ready for September.
We talked to Puka Nacua earlier, Mace. You're going to like him.
Oh, he's turning heads.
You're going to like him.
Literally. Yeah. That's a big dude.
That's a big guy. Super Crosstalk is brought to you by In-N-Out Burger. In-N-Out. That's what a hamburger's all about. We will see you tomorrow.